Meeting for Tuesday, February 28th, 2017. At this time, if I could please, I'd encourage the Girl Scouts that are joining us this evening to come stand right here in front of the desk, and perhaps you ladies could lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Whenever you're ready, go right ahead.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well done, ladies. Thank you. We'll be with you in a few minutes, okay? So, thanks a lot. Okay. The board did not have an executive session this evening, so we'll begin with item number 2 in the agenda, which is public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding their town government. I believe Mrs. Holland, a veteran of the Board of Selectmen meetings, is here this evening to say hello.
Thank you.
Hello, Mrs. Holland. How are you? Our former town clerk.
This is Cynthia Franca.
Hi.
Nice and this is Brian.
Brian Brown.
Thank you.
Hi.
And I'll be starting off tonight, so good evening, everybody. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it. My name is Brian Brown. I am in mortgages. I'm a residential mortgage loan officer. I'm new in town, relatively young family. I've only been here 2 years. And very excited about getting involved in town. I approached Norm and a few other people about how I could get involved in town and in particular the marathon and any ideas that they may have. And they brought an incredible idea to my desk through various connections, came across my desk, and that is the project that we're going to present here tonight, the Heart Card Sweat program that these ladies will give you a little bit more detail on. I was so excited about it that I've decided to underwrite it, sponsor it, and so that's why we're here. These ladies will give you a little bit more detail, but we're pretty excited about it. So I'd like to introduce Jerry and Cynthia to give a little bit more detail and take it from there.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Brian. Okay,
you have to show the slides there. Is it possible? Show the slides there on the television?
Yes.
Okay.
Brian, turn the mic.
Oh, what?
So what we would like to do...
Oh, for you, baby. Your voice.
We're going to hear those silky sounds, Jerry.
Okay, so it's a marathon art contest, and we have done this before in the past, and it's been very successful, and it's coming back into town again. So what we would like to do at this time is to give a slideshow of exactly what we're going to be doing and how is that working, Elaine. Okay, the slideshow, sir. Thank you. Okay, so it's a Hopkinton's Marathon Footprint, and the name of this this particular project is called Heart, Courage, and Sweat. Okay.
May I?
Okay, and so, Cynthia?
Okay. Thanks, Jerry. Thanks, everyone here. Thanks, Brian. It's a great honor to be part of this committee here. This is a show for young artists inspired by the marathon. You made this brief presentation here with the highlights of the project to show you. So about the eligibility, I don't know if it's good for you to see, but this call for art is open to students, to all the students, grade kindergarten through 12th grade, who are residents of Hopkinton. The theme of our call for art, you want to celebrate the heart, courage, and sweat that runners exemplify each year when they give this race their best for 26.2 miles. We want to know what inspires them, what do they love so much that they are not afraid to work harder than they ever thought possible to achieve their goal. This is our team, this is our passion. You invite them to share their passion with our town. I put some rules, these rules of the call for art here. I know you don't have a lot of time, but you are spreading the word this week. So you'll be in the media, you'll be here in schools also. So this is the rules. And this election, a local panel of artists will determine which artwork will be hung at HCA based on creativity, composition, and design. These works will be professionally framed and gifted to the artists when the show ends. Our community collaborative, this is a teamwork. You have members of our community working together for put this art going on. So we have the Hopton Center for the Arts, you have 26.2 Foundation, you have Creative Circles, Art for All, it's our art community program we're doing together, Jerry and me, and you have Guaranteed Rate Mortgage with Brian. So you are together here. This slide, I'm showing the next steps in a timeline, a short timeline. So we are doing the call for art between March 3rd and March 26th. March 27 will be the deadline for kids drop off the artwork in the main offices of the public schools and also in HCA main gallery. Between April 10th and May 18th will be the exhibition, Main Street, and between April 18th and May 18th will be the exhibition HCA gallery. In May 5th, you have our reception at HCA gallery between 6:30 and 7:30, and I'd like to invite all of you for be there. If you can be there, it'll be an honor for us. And this is our committee, 2017 Marathon Art Exhibit Committee, Michael Fano, Brian Brown, Cynthia França, Colin Giannino, Jerry Holland, Chris Waldman, and Stephanie Whelan. For us, Hopton Inspirations starts here. Thank you so much. It's a short presentation. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's awesome.
Okay,
thank you.
And also look around to, we're also going to be distributing the framed artwork in the storefronts on Main Street.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so that's going to happen also. And our ultimate goal would be to create a book that narrates all of the art throughout the years from the Marathon Art Contest, because we had done this many years ago, and so the work is phenomenal. So. Do you have any questions
Excellent.
About that?
We're
any
just questions,
trying to get the word out.
Ideas?
No, I think it's a great program. I know that it was a program that had been done in the past, and thank you to you guys for resurrecting it and bringing it back. It's good to get the kids in the schools back, you know, more into the history of the marathon and get them into the spirit so they someday can run 27 consecutive marathons till they have a skiing accident.
Thanks so much, man.
6 minutes and 3 seconds.
Yeah, we try our best to be quick here.
Okay, so as you'll see it as you go along, coming through. Thank you very much for your time. Do you have any questions at all?
No? Have you guys reached out to the schools so that you can advertise through the schools that the program's
yes,
going on?
Okay. This week, uh-huh.
Yes.
Excellent. Okay, thank you so much.
All good? Great. Thank you very much for coming in. Excellent idea. Good luck.
Great to see all of you.
I believe we have other takers for public forum this evening.
We've got a full house.
Welcome. Hello, Robert, how are you?
Chairman, I hope you're healing quickly.
Doing fine, thank you.
Bob Levinson, 13 Smith Road. I'll be brief. I just wanted to say something about the incident at Price Chopper this weekend. Mm-hmm. I think it's important to acknowledge what happened and, more importantly, what didn't happen, especially in light of some of the criticism that's been publicly stated about the police department. It's notable, again, for what didn't happen. The incident ended peacefully. No injuries, nothing, no damage to property except an innocent chair, I believe, lost a leg. But beyond that, it speaks to the professionalism, maybe the heart, sweat and courage of the local police department. Chief Lee was on the scene with Lieutenant Porter and Lieutenant Lieutenant Bennett and the rest of the force there, and I just think it should be acknowledged, and I am very grateful for the service that they provide the town. I think we all should be. So, thank
you. Completely agree. Thank you for bringing it up. Excellent points. Anybody else? Mr. LeGoy.
Good evening, and I won't mention anything about your leg.
Thank you.
I just had two quick points. I'm here representing the Trails Club. Trails Club will be holding a trail forum on March 8th, so next Wednesday, at the Senior Center from 7 to 9. The purpose is to talk about trails past, present, and future in Hopkinton, primarily to there'll be again, two hours of discussion. There'll be some breakout sessions, but the general focus is on letting people know the trails that we have in town and then looking at moving forward in town on trails. My second point is, as part of that, started work last Tuesday on a group, sort of joint town professionals and volunteers working on trail mapping. So trying to get public trails in town put on the town GIS system. So it's not as simple as you would think it would be, but we've got a good group of folks working on that. So hopefully we'll be able to give you more progress on that in the near future. So that's all, and
great.
Talk to you later.
Thank you for bringing it to our attention.
What time?
Senior Center.
Senior Center.
Senior Center. Thank you.
7 to 9,
Senior Center.
Okay. Good. Thank you, Peter. Anybody else for public forum? Okay, so with that, we're going to invite our guest this evening, Girl Scout Troop 75436, led by Scout Leader Laura Davis, to join us, and any other Scout leaders that would like to come forward. And if we could have a couple of the young ladies perhaps have a seat. Three can sit and three can stand, or four can stand behind, however you want to do it.
Okay, girls, if you would introduce yourselves, that would be great. Your name.
Great, thank you. So ladies, why don't you take a second and introduce yourselves one at a time.
I'm Kira.
Kira.
I'm Karen.
Hi.
I'm May.
Hi.
I'm Avery.
Hi, Avery.
I'm Heather.
Hi,
Heather.
I'm Lily.
I'm Appa.
Great, nice to meet you all. Thank you for coming tonight. So tell us, what have you been doing here in the last year studying the air and how you can improve the quality of the air in Hockington and around the world?
So for our breathe journey, we went on a trip to learn more about air quality and the effects air can have on our senses. We wanted to use what we learned to improve office environments in ways such as mood and air quality by using plants.
Excellent.
This has been a year-long journey for them. And the journey is about the equivalent of about 3 or 4 different badges, and it's a prerequisite of the Silver Award. So they're happy it's finished so we can get on to more important things.
Excellent.
We do hope that you enjoy the plants.
Yeah, so tell us about the plants that are on the table right there in front of you.
Well, these are aloe plants.
Those were day lilies.
Oh, those were day lilies.
Peace lily.
Which we read were like the best for improving air quality and mood.
And these are scattered throughout Town Hall now. Are you guys distributed them throughout Town Hall on behalf of the community? That's fantastic. Thank you very much. Did you enjoy this project? Are you just glad it's over? Did you enjoy it while you're doing it? You did enjoy it? Great. Well, you've done a great job, and we really appreciate it very much. We've had the plants out now for a couple of meetings. And we hope we can continue to display them as we go forward. Thank you all for coming tonight. You guys checked yourselves out on TV. Everybody wave. Wave to the camera. Just go like this. Wave and look up. You'll see yourself on TV. All right. Okay, well, great. Thank you for coming. We appreciate all your hard work. And keep it up. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good job. Now that we've got nice clean air in Town Hall, we can move on with the town's business. Consent agenda. Item 1 is some minutes from 2:14. Item 2 is a parade permit for Live for Evan for the 5th annual Live for Evan 5K run walk. Item 3 is a board appointment, William Marr or Don Ronan to the Youth Commission. And then item 4 is marathon fund requests, A being 3235 for post-prom, and B being 2183 or 84 for the Friends of Hopkinton Inc. for renting bouncy houses. These are for Family Day to be held on Saturday, September 16th at the high school and middle school. Anybody want to break out any of the consent agenda items?
Break out.
Mr. Chair, I don't believe item 3 belongs on the consent agenda since it's a decision that needs to be made rather than just a vote, a simple vote.
So we're going to break that out. Okay. Anything else?
Yeah, I would. I have a few questions on the marathon fund, so item 4 I'd like to discuss.
Take those out. That leaves items 1 and 2, which is minutes and a parade permit for the Live for Evan 5K run walk. I believe Mr. Girardi's here this evening. Are you here, Mr. Girardi, for the Live for Evan 5K run walk?
I am.
Okay. Yeah, if you would, please, just real quick, if you could share just how it's gone so far and if there's anything you need from the board.
I'm Michael Girardi, 92 Spring Street, Hopkinton, board member for Live for Evan organization, and I'm here tonight in support of the permit application. The organization is doing well. As you know, we take the funds from the race event and put it right back into cardiac, mainly pediatric cardiac patients. Happy to report that we just renewed our apartment that we lease at the Longwood Galleria in Boston. We rent a fully furnished apartment on the 12th floor, connected to Children's, and needy families of cardiac patients who need housing, typically long-term housing, we pick up the bill on that, and we
awesome.
Put people in there as they're needed. So we work with Children's on the coordination and the staffing and the queue of people into this house, into this apartment, but we fund it all. So we just renewed the lease for that with Children's and looking to do more. So this event is important to us. It helps us fund most of the money that we get from it. Goes right back into the apartment. I think our long-term plans is we'll break away privately and still do the same type of work, but we'll just do it under our umbrella ourselves.
Great. So. Great. Thank you for that update. Sure. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve items 1 and 2 of the consent agenda minutes and the parade permit for the Live for Evan 5K run walk.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you very
much
for coming in.
Thanks
great
for
job.
Yeah.
Thank
you
very much. And great job with all you're doing there. Okay, item number 3, Mr. Sestari. Do we have the two applicants with us this evening by chance for the Youth Commission, William Marr or Don Ronan? We have Don. Okay, is Mr. Marr here by chance?
Nope.
Okay, is the chair of the Youth Commission here this evening by chance?
Through the chair.
Thank you, Denise. Mr. Kamal.
I was going to say the same thing.
Okay. Okay, so Mr. Sestari.
No, just felt it. I mean, obviously, it needs to be pulled. I think the consent agenda is intended for items that can be just voted, simply voted up or down altogether, where no further discussion is required. And if we're making a choice between two people, we need to have discussion.
I agree. Okay, so with Ms. Ronan here, I think it would be appropriate for the board to say hello for a couple of minutes and gauge your interest, and then we'll take it from there. Ms. Ronan, if you would join us, please, at the guest table. Hi, Dawn. How are you?
Hi. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. So if you would be so kind and introduce yourself to those watching and give us your interest in the Youth Commission.
Hey, so I'm Dawn Ronan. I've lived in Hopkinton now with my husband a little over 20 years. Three girls, one has graduated through the system, and I still have two in the school system. So I've had the opportunity to be involved with the kids in a lot of different areas. I currently sit on two school councils, Elmwood and Hopkins. So I hear from the teacher's perspective where their struggles might be, where their challenges are. I have two Girl Scout troops, a third grade troop, and a ninth grade troop. So I kind of know where the kids are at different ranges. And what's changed? The pressures on children today. So it's just another way. Hopkinton does great. I mean, Kathy McLeod is amazing with always trying to be aware and implementing programs and things we can do to kind of help the youth. And if we can sort of help bridge a gap and work together and support our youth in town, how powerful, you know, is that? So I was approached, took some time to think of it. My school council commitment with Elmwood is done at the end of this year. So I thought, now's the time.
Okay, great. Have you talked to the chair of the Youth Commission?
That's who actually approached me. Okay. Margie Wiggins.
Got it. Okay, so. Great. Excellent. Thank you for that introduction. Mr. Sestari, any questions, thoughts?
No questions in particular. Thank you for stepping forward. And it sounds like you're very, very busy now as it is. And to take that extra step, obviously, is greater commitment. But we need people like you in the community.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wright?
Don, thank you for coming tonight and explaining a little more about yourself. This is one of my ongoing gripes about our application form that gives such sketchy information. It's very hard to really see inside the very limited info. So I'm really happy to hear, your background, your interest. I think this is a board that would really look for people that have that connectivity with youth. And so I'm delighted to see your application, and I would certainly support you as a good new contributing member to that board.
Thank you. Tino.
He really thanks for stepping up. It's funny, just to pick up on what she was just saying, is the information that comes to us is about 15 or 18 words. And so when people don't show up, it's really hard for us to consider them, because you just fill this in with so much information. And it's great, the Girl Scout troops and everything else. I think you'll be a great addition. Thank you for
good.
Coming.
Thank you.
Yes, I mirror everyone else's sentiments, and it goes a long way with me personally when people that are going for these positions come up and actually sit on the hot seat and sell themselves. And I know it's not an easy thing for most to do, and thank you for doing it.
Thank you.
Mr. Kamala, were we able to reach out to the other candidate by chance?
I believe so.
And weren't able to connect, or do we know?
I don't know if the candidate indicated any reason to Maria why they may not be able to make the meeting.
Okay. All right, so is the board inclined to go ahead then? My sense is we are.
I would make a motion to appoint Don Ronan to the vacant position to the Youth Commission for a term of 1 year, one term expiring June 30th, 2019.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, Don.
Thank you for the opportunity.
We appreciate you stepping forward. Take care. Okay, item number four, marathon fund request. Mrs. Wright.
Yeah. I'm new to this, so, maybe I don't know enough about how the marathon fund operates, but I looked at the listing that was provided here of the balances, and I think these are all, excellent requests. I'm not questioning that, but I don't completely understand how these cash balances are displayed. Most specifically, it appears that the Hopkinton Family Day is the 300th celebration has now kind of rolled over into a some kind of a Hopkinton family celebration, and I was looking at the original and remaining amounts in these funds, and I noticed that the 300th from 2015 had 2,708, 450 remaining, which comes up to another 450, I think, comes up to a remaining of $3,788. So I wondered where that money went, and is that still outstanding? And since there is no more 300th, are those funds that could be used for this? Can you explain, or someone explain to me, how this marathon fund inflow and outflow and remaining funds works?
So, yes. Mr. Kamal, if you could give an overview of how that works, but I think the specific accounting, we're going to ask that we table that and you guys figure that out between now and the next meeting. But let's go ahead and just do the overview first.
Yes. The Marathon Fund Committee is charged with dispersing the Marathon Fund to qualifying groups in town. Mm-hmm. That money comes in as part of the gift by the BAA to the town.
Annually?
Mm-hmm. Annually. And that gift is broken up into two components. The first component is used towards paying for the expenses related to the marathon incurred by town departments. After paying for those expenses, the remainder is then sent to the Marathon Fund Committee to be used towards scholarships to support local organizations. Over the years, I can share with the board that there have been balances from that are carried over from 1 year to the next year. Mm-hmm. So basically, that's how the process works. Mm-hmm. We can sit down with you and go through the accounting process one-on-one. Specific to the question regarding the remaining funds in the 300th Celebration Committee, that committee is distinct and different from the request that is before the board now. The 300th Celebration Committee was a town committee.
Right.
The group that is looking at holding the Hopkinton Annual Day is not a town committee. The 300th Celebration Committee, I believe, finalized its report in terms of its fund balances. And we can research that and contact you with the outcome from the research. At this point, I don't believe there may be any funds that are available to be transferred from that committee to these activities. If they are, I think that's an idea worth considering, but I'll have to engage with the accounting department to see if that is possible. So, in answer to your question, these are two distinct entities. The 300th Celebration Committee is a town committee. Mm-hmm. This entity that is now requesting funding from the Marathon Fund Committee to celebrate Hopkinton Day annually is not a town committee at this point.
That makes sense?
No, I guess so. I just didn't understand why, you know, we're still seeing 300th and outstanding funds that, So we have $20,000, $525 to work with. And just one more question, the money that comes in from the marathon, is that a set amount each year, or is it a percentage of the take that the marathon brings in? Do we know how much comes into that fund?
It's negotiated on a year-to-year basis. Mm-hmm. The thinking behind the negotiation always is one that the town is able to fund and pay for the expenses that the town departments incur.
Obviously, yeah.
And we also have emphasized that the marathon is a community asset, and if the opportunities to strengthen community organizations through a community benefit fund, that we also request the BAA to make that funding available.
No, I'm not questioning the merits. I just was wanting more information as to how that fund works and how the funds come in, and you know how much we can anticipate in terms of funds each year. So, all right, thank you.
I think it was like $115,000 last year, $118,000.
$118,000.
That's the magnitude of it, give or take a few grand. And the town expenses, I think, have been running in the. It used to be 60, maybe it's 75 or 80 grand now. So there's $20,000 or $25,000 that kind of flows to this work here, and then this group of volunteers kind of has people submit applications, and they go through a process, and then when they approve, then they come to us for final approval.
Okay.
But as far as the specific dollars go, I think there's some legit questions. I mean, she should be able to look at this form and understand within 2 minutes where the money is, and that. Obviously, that's not the case. So we should ask that Chris and you or somebody sit down and just go through that.
Yeah.
Okay. Sort of on a sidebar. Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I've got another question on this sheet. You know, I'm seeing at the top that currently the cash balance of the marathon fund is $25,000 and change. As we look down the right-hand column, we can see how much was granted to various groups. And then there's another column remaining, which I'm assuming is the monies that weren't spent from each of those grants, if you will. How long do we allow that to be outstanding before we claw it back and just say, okay, you know, we approved it in 2012, you still haven't used it, that's no longer yours, that's back in the marathon fund.
Well, like the 300th committee, which is no longer.
In fact, that's a question I'll discuss with the finance director. I think, though, for the most part, the remaining balances I believe are for from the 2016 period would still be active.
However, yeah, and I can understand that, yeah. But you know, we're tying up, you know, right now we're tying up about 20% of the balance, and granted, most of it is within the last year, and that's reasonable. But it seems like we need to put some kind of a time limit on that, though.
I think it's a revolving account, though, by setup. It's not like an encumbered account where, you know, June 30th, that's it. You don't spend it, you lose it.
Yeah, but his question, we approved something in 2012, and they haven't spent all of it. I don't think that money should still be in that particular group's hands.
So maybe the thing to do is if we could get with the finance team and the chair of the Marathon Fund Committee and just kind of do a quick overview. And perhaps share it with us at a future meeting. All right?
Yeah, we'll do so.
Okay. Mr. Catino, do you have something you want to say? I know you're on that.
Well, no, because I'm on the Marathon Fund and the Marathon Fund Committee. And we really do vet every single request that comes in to make sure that they are worthy and well qualified.
Okay.
Before they come to the
I would like more clarification on how these numbers are derived at, though, because this remaining column, if you add it up, it doesn't add up to $4,528.78. It adds up to a whole lot more.
It's a good point.
So these numbers aren't adding up, and I'm, you know, it's just the numbers should make sense. So point taken.
Must be that new math.
Okay, so with that, and I think those are fair points and concerns to be addressed. So if you could follow up with Mr. Kamalo on that directly, and you can get with the Marathon Fund Committee folks. Is anyone inclined to approve the two, or make a motion to approve the two requests in front of us this evening?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to approve the $3,235 for the post-prom party committee, and $2,183.97 from the Friends of Hopkinton.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to approve those two items. Any further discussion on those two items of the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you very much.
Is that okay, motion? I cut off all there.
Yeah, no, it's good. So those two will go forward. Okay, item number four on the agenda now is a FY18 comprehensive budget review. We had a budget review discussion with most of our colleagues. The school committee was not able to attend the last meeting we had because of scheduling conflicts, and we probably would have never got to them anyway, given everyone else that was here. So we're going to ask our friends from the school committee to join us at the guest tables, and we'll continue our FY18 budget discussion. And we're going to have Mr. Kamalo do a quick sort of reset of where we are to start off, if that's okay with you, Mr. Kamalo.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think it's going to be more than a reset.
We have enough chairs for everybody?
I think we need one for Ralph.
Ralph, you have one here, and we need... Town clerk is going to assist us and grab another one out of the other room.
Boy, you just kidding. Yeah, watch it. Yeah, do it again.
Dr. McLeod. Everybody good? Welcome all. Thank you for coming tonight. We had slotted an hour for this. We will do our absolute best to keep to an hour because we have other things to cover and everyone has other things to do. So, Mr. Kamalo, thoughts?
Mr. Chair, if I may, we also have members of the Appropriations Committee.
Okay.
We could get chairs for them and invite them over to the...
Okay. How many members of the Appropriations Committee would like to join us? I see two. If someone would be so kind, our facilities engineer is on the job. He's going to go get a couple of chairs. And our appropriations colleagues can join us right here.
Can I get a glass?
team.
Hi.
Good evening.
Hi. How you guys doing? What's that, Mr. Kamal, please?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening to the school committee as well as the appropriations committee members. Just to perhaps reset the conversation, I think it's worth pointing out that the comprehensive budget that the town manager, working with Chris Sandini, who's done all the heavy lifting, focused on, I think, the following choices as we were working through our proposals. We were focused on carefully balancing the choices required to respond to the diverse needs and priorities that have been identified by the boards and committees. What we have learned over the years is that the town's boards and committees really do a good job in making sure that the budgets that they put forth reflect the needs that have been conveyed to them by the town residents. We were also interested in maintaining the quality services that the town residents now continue to expect to receive from Town Hall. There was also an interest in responding to the impact of the increase in the debt service owing to the coming online of three major projects: the elementary school, DPW facility, the library project. In also speaking with different entities in town, particularly with regard to public safety, as well as infrastructure requirements in town, our thinking as we were developing the budget focused on the need to respond to the growth in town. I can tell you, if you look along 495, I challenge anybody to identify any other community that is growing as fast as Hopkinton. And then finally, as has been said over the years, it's one thing to balance the budget, but I think what I have learned over the last 7 years is the need to make sure that we take into account the impact of the expenses that we propose on the taxpayer. Over the years, by illustration, the board has been very careful in terms of addressing that issue. It has come up previously when the Board of Selectmen, working collaboratively with the Appropriations Committee, moved forward an underwrite vote. This issue has come up in prior discussions regarding how the town manages the excess levy. This issue has come up multiple times when the Selectmen have defined the budget message. And this was the case also a few months ago when the Selectmen set the budget message for FY18. Over the years, I think the town has prided itself in terms of focusing not just on the requests as they come in for a specific year. The focus has always been strategic, grounded on the following principles: governance, accountability, visibility, aligning the funding plan to the town's overall vision and strategy as identified by the different boards and committees in town. And finally, I think we pride ourselves in adhering to a very rigorous process that is public, that is inclusive, and we're always looking for opportunities to improve in that regard. Specifically, and I should credit Chris Sandini in terms of how we arrived at projecting the total appropriated budget relative to town programs and services. In the past, and in fact you can see this if you look at the financial model, in the past we have identified that number by grouping what happens with the appropriations required to fund the programs and services through taxation together with the enterprise accounts. we have decided this time to remove the enterprise accounts from the calculation of this number for the simple reason that the enterprise funds are paid for differently, specifically water and sewer. We do account for the government subsidy that is paid towards the Park and Rec Commission's programs. And thus, that amount is proposed at 58,543,907. This is an increase of approximately 2.2 million or 4% from the fiscal 2017 approved budget. It represents an overall tax impact of 3.87 net of new growth. And again, I think as we have said in the past, the big number here is accounted for by the debt service that is now coming online. The recommended non-enterprise fund capital improvement program totals approximately 8.2 million, of which 7.1 million will be bonded, and the remaining 1.1 million will be pay as you go. And this is one of the areas where we'll be applying free cash in the FY18 budget. And I think it needs to be said that as we have emphasized in prior years, balancing debt with pay-as-you-go protects the town from unforeseen costs, and most importantly, it has been well received by our bond rating agencies. That in itself has a direct impact on the cost of debt service going forward. Specifically, with regard to the operating budgets, here are the changes. General government is going up by 3.31%. Public safety, 3.22%. Hopkinton Public Schools, 4.13%. The Regional Tech Vocational School, 3%. Public Works, 2.39%. Health and Human Services, 14.98%. It needs to be said, in fact, the HR department is level funded. The reason why we have the 14.98% accounts for the most part, the money that was moved for training purposes from other individual town budgets into the HR budget. So this is not new money. Culture and recreation is up 11.37%. Debt service needs to be said, I'll say this so slowly, 56.46%. Employee benefits and insurance, 6.74%.
Mr. Kamal, can I make a suggestion? Can we stop for a moment and let's just talk operating budgets for a few minutes? Because I think we might be able to get past this, and then we won't have to come back to this necessarily, and then we can get into next steps, if you will, including capital items. Is that okay?
That's fine.
Is that all right with you? You sure?
That's fine.
Okay. Okay, so we just went through the operating budgets, which everybody has a summation in front of them. Chris obviously has seen this ad nauseum. Ralph, I'm sure you've seen quite a bit of this too. Does anybody have any questions specific to the general government through employee benefits and insurance categories for operating budget at this time?
I have a question on how many students do we have that go to the Keefe Tech? Do we know that?
That's not our budget, so I don't have that information.
If you're not going to quote me on it, I believe it's just shy, just a little over 100.
So we have 100 students that go to Keefe Tech?
I don't think that's
even remotely possible. Yeah. I would guess that it's less than 30.
Yeah. In fact.
So what is the? Okay, let's try this. Behind your question, what is it you're trying to sort out?
Well, I'm looking at the line item for $363,000, and if we have 30 students going there, it would be cheaper to send our kids to Northeastern than to send them to Keefe Tech.
It is very expensive to send kids to the technical school.
I went there.
It's very expensive.
I don't with, I don't know if there's a chance that you can, that we as a town can relook at our agreement with them or what, but if...
What they do over there is basically take how many students you're sending as a percentage of their total enrollment,
yeah,
and then they divide up their budget by that,
yeah,
and you pay your percentage.
Okay. We have a member of the town of Hopkinton, if not two members from the town of Hopkinton, that serve on the Keith Tech school board.
Yep.
I don't know who they are at the moment.
This is Knowles. She's been there since I went there.
And there's Knowles. Another. Who are our two members?
Frank?
In fact, our liaison is Mr.
Yeah,
Tedstone.
I'm the liaison to it.
Yeah. Okay.
Specific to your question, Brendan, we will look at the numbers and give you the answer,
yeah,
in terms of how many we had last year and how many they are projecting for this coming year.
Okay.
We've been in that range of 325 to 375 for the last 10 years,
yeah,
depending on the number of students.
Well, there's...
But I don't know what that number is. I don't think it's that high.
I'm actually looking up. In FY16, it was 19 students. In FY17, it was 16 students.
Okay, so 16, that's almost $40,000 per student per year to go to Keith Tech.
Very expensive.
So there might be a way, I mean, we that might be something we look at down the road that might not be.
State law is going to require that we make that available to the students.
How many students?
19.
19? So around 18 grand.
1,800.
Yeah.
Anything else on that?
That was just a number that jumped out at me. That was before, like when I went there, the Hopkinton school system wasn't where it is today. Like today, it's a premier school system, and people don't generally want to leave Hopkinton to go to a Marion or a Keefe or wherever because they're getting the same thing here. Now that the school system is where it is, I don't know if there's a way to relook at our agreement with them or not, but you know, where we're trying to tighten our belt with the budget moving forward, it just, you know, it seems crazy to spend $30,000 a year to send a kid to Keefe when you know what I'm saying?
No, I understand.
I don't know what our parameters are to take a look at it or whatnot, but just
Mr.
something.
Kamala, any thoughts?
It's an agreement that is predicated on state law. It's an agreement that the town agreed to. I believe if there's an opportunity to revise and all the towns that signed up to the agreement agree, then that may be possible. But otherwise, every other community I've worked for, making any adjustments to those regional agreements has been very difficult. What ends up occurring is the dissolution of the regional agreement.
And on that agreement, if we pay, if they bring out their budget and they figure that out per student, are you saying that if we pay $30,000 for 16 students that go there, the other 800, if there were 800 from Framingham that go there, are they paying the same rate per student as us?
I believe the formula may apply differently to different communities.
That doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
But you don't make that rule, so.
Exactly, yeah.
Anything else?
That's it.
Okay, anything else in the operating budget sections for the schools? You guys good with what we have here for right now on the operating budgets?
I'd like to hear from the schools a breakdown of the increase and how much is due to increased population in the schools, where the increases are coming from.
Okay. Can somebody share just sort of the macro numbers as to where the breakdowns come in?
Sure.
Mr. Dumas.
So, for enrollments, as of October 1st...
Chris, would you mind moving the microphone, please?
As of October 1st of this year, we were responsible for 3,497 students. Seven of those go to Norfolk Aggie, which we're required to pay the tuition and transportation for out of our operating budget. It costs roughly $25,000 per pupil to go to Norfolk Aggie. Projected in FY18, we have 3,528, so that's 31 more students. But I know we've had conversations right in this room in the not too distant past about the fact that it's not just the numbers that are important, it's the needs of the pupils, because the pupils that we're going to have next year are not necessarily the same pupils that we have this year. We have a senior class that's graduating. We have new kindergarten students obviously coming in with different needs. We have changing demographics in the town, which impact our English language learner students as well as our special education population. That being said, if we did nothing next year other than continue with the same level of staffing that we currently have, our fixed costs for those people would be up $1.1 million. Our total increase is 1.6, 1.7. So those contractual obligations, I'll just key in on the teaching contract because that's the largest collective bargaining group that we have. There is a 2.5% increase built into the contract. This is the last of 3 years under the contract, which was, I believe, 2 to 2.5. So it was sort of rear end loaded. Then we also have teachers who can, what we call, get column changes by attaining additional educational credits, such as going from a bachelor's degree to a master's degree. They get paid more. And then you have steps, and step is related to the passage of time. There are 13 steps in the teacher contract. So I don't have all of those statistics with me right now, but the vast number of our teachers continue to make those moves. So not only are they getting a 2.5% pay increase, they can get more money by getting a degree. They can get and will get more money by just coming back a year. But I said earlier, if that's all we were going to do, our fixed costs would have gone up $1 million. But because of changing needs, we've made reductions in existing personnel that are offset by increases in new personnel to respond to some of the needs, in particular the ELL and the special education needs. So our total payroll is going up roughly $1.3 million. Our expenses are going up $421,000. Included in those expense increases is the need for an additional school bus to respond to the needs on the western side of the town. Western side of the town, in particular at the secondary level, the buses are jammed, and we don't have room for the new kids that we know are going to move into Hopkinton Mews and already have begun. So we've put into this budget an additional bus, and that's $60,000. There are also increases in our textbook accounts, and those are to respond to new science curriculum that's been implemented by the state. Then we have additional students going to, I mentioned Norfolk Aggie earlier. The FY17 budget assumed that we would have 5 kids there. I said earlier we have 7. So we're projecting that we'll have 7 next year. The difference between 5 kids and 7 kids is roughly $50,000. So that's part of this. And then special education, our increases are estimated to be a little bit more than $300,000. And one of the big drivers there is actually a decrease in the amount of state circuit breaker money that we're going to be receiving. We receive circuit breaker money a year after we expend. Circuit breaker is a means for the state to contribute towards the education of high-priced special needs kids, mostly kids that are going out of district. Some could cost $100,000. The way it works is that we have to spend $40,000, and anything above $40,000, the state will reimburse us up to the statutory cap of 75%. So we anticipate having less money coming back to us next year from the kids that we know we have out this year. The FY17 budget used money that we earned last year, where we had higher priced kids, more kids out. So when you bring kids back into the district, you lose out on the circuit breaker money, but in theory, it's costing you less to educate them here in town. So I know that was a little bit bigger than a nutshell, but overall you add those numbers together and you're up about $1.7 million. Mm-hmm.
And now, in the coming couple of years, when we open up the new school, roughly how much more headcount are we thinking that we're going to be adding in terms of employees, teachers?
Now, that's really a good question, and that's directly related to the request that was made at Town Hall for additional classrooms. Was it four additional classrooms? Mm-hmm. So you'll have four additional teachers, probably a para in each one of those. And we've known right from the start, when we submitted our projected financials to the MSBA 4 or 5 years ago, we knew we would need an additional custodian because the footprint's a lot bigger than the center school. At this point, those are the ones that I would say are more or less fixed costs. You know, once you get into special needs, when you have more kids, you were going to have more special needs personnel probably anyway, mm-hmm. whether you were in the old school or the new school. The ones I mentioned, though, earlier, you know, the four teachers, you're going to need as a result of the new school.
So we're looking at about three-quarters of the increase being on the payroll and contractual obligations. We're looking at increasing headcount in the next couple of years. I look at this negotiating year that you guys have on your hands as being pretty critical. There's only so much that we can keep on putting on top of our tax bills each year for everybody in town before they can't take it anymore. And I see the increase, and everybody here is doing what they need to do to, you know, make sure our kids have a quality education and all that, but we need to really understand that, and I think that it's incumbent to make the union aware that we don't have bottomless pockets here, and this needs to be a good negotiation, I think, for the town.
John.
You don't already try that.
But. I just want to clarify, make sure everybody understands in terms of the budget building process. So the nice thing, the four classrooms and even the configuration of the new elementary school originally was also designed to reduce class sizes over what we have in the center school right now. So we've got kindergarten classes that have 21 kids, 24 kids, which is way too many for a kindergarten class. And the reason I bring that up is it's not necessarily a pure cutover of headcount. So we might have additional staff in a classroom right now because there are 24 kindergartners and you need more people. But just because we're adding classrooms doesn't necessarily mean we're going to add the exact same headcount per classroom. Mm-hmm. That'll be Mrs. DeBow, Dr. McLeod, whoever replaces Mr. Dumas.
New Ralph.
New Ralph will, and obviously
can't you guys
the school
find someone named Chris?
Will be
we
put that in the job listing.
We tried, it didn't work.
But
New Ralph.
So that'll be built.
It's like a boy band.
Obviously based on the need. So I don't want you to think every single classroom comes with the exact same formula. We're looking at different numbers of kids in these classrooms, so obviously we'd be taking a look at that.
Well, I mean, I think that just illustrates that the impact's going to be even greater, and that when it comes time for this next contract and we look at the impact over the next 3 years, on top of knowing that we're going to be having more debt service coming online and things like that, it's really critical to do our best in these negotiations.
Lori.
I just wanted to speak also to the negotiation piece. I mean, just to add on to what John was saying, is that we don't necessarily know that four additional teachers will be needed. We may have classrooms that are co-taught now with two teachers, that when you reduce the classroom size, you need to be able to split those two teachers and have the same staffing levels. We don't have those answers definitively yet, because we don't, A, know the students' needs that are coming in, and have those configurations set. But in terms of the negotiation, I was part of the team that negotiated the current contract. And what I would want to state for the public and for the board to understand is that, you know, from our budget standpoint, our salary percentage to expense percentage has not changed a number of years. We've been at 83% for salary and 17% for other expenses. As part of that negotiation team, which that negotiation took over a year, and we were benchmarking against other districts that were comparable to Hopkinton, I would caution, because I will not be on the negotiation team for the next contract, that you're going to be hard-pressed to have those numbers be much lower than they are in this current contract, or you're going to lose teachers. So I don't know that you're going to get to a place that's more fair than where we are at, but that's my personal opinion based on the benchmarking I saw, the numbers that we are seeing other districts being forced into, not to mention the caliber of teachers that we have in this district. So that would be my caution to everybody in regards to the negotiations.
Okay. Anything else on the general operating budgets? Mrs. Wright?
Not right now.
Okay. Anybody else?
I just have a quick question, Mr. Dumas. Would you mention the state science mandated? Is that an unfunded mandate? Do we get it?
Absolutely. One of many. No, your favorite kind.
Yeah, okay. That's what I figured you would say.
I didn't know there was another kind.
You good? Mr. Tedstone, anything else? Mr. Kamalo, anything? Thoughts about operating budgets?
No.
Mrs. Lazarus? AC? Everybody good? Anyone else? Thoughts?
Mr. Chair, I do have one question. So this is, this year, the teachers are getting a 2.5% increase, correct? And this is the third year of their three-year contract?
Correct.
So next year?
Is a negotiation.
It's a negotiation. So who inevitably approves that? Do we approve that? You guys approve that. So what's to say, what's to say, worst case scenario, you guys, the teachers say we want 10% raise? I know that's a crazy number, but
that's the number we started at for the last negotiation.
So knowing the negotiation process when it comes to unions, personally, at what point do you look at it and say, all right, well, we'll give you your 3%, but you're going to have to lose 25 teachers for that. And I'm using silly numbers right now. But at some point, if the teachers are getting 2.5% and the highway or the fire or the police are getting 1%, what makes it okay for the teachers union to get, or vice versa, say the highway department or the DPW is getting a 4% increase and the teachers are getting 2%. At what point do we level off and say, what makes a teacher any more important than a police officer, any more important than a DPW employee?
Can I just jump in?
Sure.
Just to you know, because all of us that have been at the table, I know we need to be careful about not violating the parameters of the process and the conversations that we have at the table, but I do want to reinforce that Mr. Kamalo really ably represents the interests of the town and the Board of Selectmen in all of our negotiation meetings with the teachers' union. So it's very helpful to have that understanding as we are, you know, kind of going back and forth between their representatives and our attorneys, you know, what is comparable not only with other school districts, but certainly within the town. So just please rest assured that that is absolutely information that we ask for and review very carefully, and is absolutely critical to the process.
And I just want to let you know that I'm playing devil's advocate. I have two young kids that are going to enjoy the school system for the next, you know, I have a third grader and a first grader, so I'm looking forward to my kids, and if we could afford to have a 6-to-1 student to teacher ratio, I'd be all for it personally. But, you know, from what I hear from everybody in the town, this is one of those things where, you know, there was a few years ago that there was a, you know, when the talk about it might have been 10 years ago, might have been 15, I'm not sure exactly, but there was the scare tactic that said, if this contract doesn't get approved, we're going to lay off 125 teachers. And it went to the town meeting, and it didn't get approved, and there wasn't one teacher that was laid off. So it left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth, not mine personally, but a lot of people. And this is kind of my thing, where I'm just kind of bringing it out. I'm new to this process. I'm new to budget processes. So I'm just trying to wrap my head around it. And I don't want you to think that I'm anti-schools, because I could not further personally be, you know, that couldn't be further from the truth. I'm very pro-schools, but I'm just trying to think in the line of for the town.
Okay, so with that, I'd encourage us to move on. We have several other topics to cover specific to budget, and then we got to talk about how we're going to pay for it. Mr. Camallo, could you then walk us through what's found on page 2, which is the FY18 capital project request pay-go table. Everyone see what we're looking at? Okay, so.
Yep.
Has not been updated since we last discussed it.
Okay, well, we can update it here on the fly a little bit, but it's pretty close. I know what you're talking about, but it's pretty close. Mr. Camallo.
This is a list that is still under consideration and review. As Mrs. Nickerson pointed out, there was a discussion yesterday that identified, I think, the last two projects as coming off the list because they are duplicates of an item that is already listed.
So if you could hold for 1 minute, please. If everybody could cross off where it says wireless access points, $80,000, take it off your list. And right above that, it says high school sound auditorium equipment, $30,000, take it off your list. Those items are going to be handled, but they're handled in numbers above.
Yes.
Everybody good? Okay, Mr. Camallo.
Again, starting off by summarizing the very rigorous process. It's the committees, boards, and departments that identify the projects. They lay out those projects within the capital improvement plan for the respective department. That plan is presented for review to the Capital Improvement Committee, and thus the projects that you see on the list were recommended to the town manager per the charter process by the Capital Improvement Committee following extensive discussions with the proposing entities.
So, Mr. Camallo, these items on this list, minus the last two, the remaining items on this list on page 2, these items, if paid for using free cash or other means, are inside that 3.87% tax increase today. Correct?
Specifically, I think based on what I think you are asking, the answer is yes. The answer is yes. But because we're paying for these projects through free cash.
Correct.
Okay. Okay, they include the following.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
The ones we crossed off, wireless access points, I'm assuming that's being bundled into system-wide technology upgrades?
Correct.
Correct.
So that's 80,000 out of the 100,000 that's designated there?
No, the 80,000 is in that 100,000. There's another 20 on top of that.
That's what I said. I said it's bundled in to the 100,000.
Okay.
Yes.
And then the auditorium sound equipment, where is that bundled into?
Same place.
Yeah,
it doesn't add up,
so it's a rounding thing.
The system-wide technology upgrades encompass those two items and will cost $100,000.
Okay, so there's nothing else in the system-wide technology upgrades, just those two? Thank you.
And thus, the list includes the vehicle Ford Explorer for the Highway Department. I can tell you, and we have explained this to the board, Mike Mensa does a fantastic job responding to storm events and other emergencies in town. We had a huge issue trying to pass the vehicle's inspection last time around, and clearly he needs to replace this vehicle.
So let's do this, Mr. Camallo. Again, I'm just going to be a pain in the butt tonight trying to keep us moving, okay? So please forgive me for my interruptions. They're not directed at any one individual at all. Mr. Camallo or anybody else, is there anything on this list of these pay-as-you-go items that gives you serious heartburn or you're very concerned about including in the budget going forward.
Wondering if we can sell a dam to Milford for a buck.
I don't appreciate that language.
A dollar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To the chair, the security upgrades, is that like phase two or phase three of the stuff that we started a couple of years ago?
Which phase is it?
System-wide security.
Which phase are we on?
Phase three.
But it's part of an ongoing plan. Yeah.
How many phases were there going to be?
I think there's four.
Well, probably a lot.
And with the understanding that there's four in the current plan, but security is something that's changing every year. So to say that a couple of years from now we won't have anything is probably not accurate.
So, at what point does that end up going into the operating budget then? Just if it's going to be repeating like that?
But I mean, it's right now it's capital items. I mean, I don't think it can go into the operating budget when you're talking about, again, without going into too many details. I mean, it's equipment and things like that. So those are at that number, I believe, that end up being capital items.
Any projects jump out at anybody?
I have a question on the police line item that's gone down $40,000. Obviously, we went from three to two vehicles. Will that allow us to keep the third vehicle that's not being replaced? Is it, we're not going to have problems with it? Like, I know you can't foresee it down the road, but it's not going to leave us with two good cruisers and one that, you know, might not make it. You know, it has 400,000 miles on it. You know, like, are we still in the good category where you're confident with that?
Three would be nice, but yeah. Make some adjustments with the two.
Yep. Yep.
How many did we get last year? How many were requested and how many did we get?
Last year we requested three.
Three. Received two.
So maybe next year just request two.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, staying focused, please. Staying focused. Mr. Sestari.
I don't know if I'm comfortable kicking that can further down the road.
Okay, I hear a motion to increase that to three.
I would certainly favor that.
Okay, so we'll come back to that one. So that's one that we're thinking about. Okay, Mr. Kamal, if you could circle that one for us. Any others, folks?
The fire, the boiler replacement, we've dropped 50,000, so we're not going to replace that. Chief, we're able to limp through another year with that boiler?
Could I speak to that?
You sure can.
Thank you. We are finding alternate funding sources. It actually shouldn't wait until next year, according to the facilities director. Mm. So we're going to find an alternate means to
Excellent.
Fund it.
Excellent.
And the same with the one below that.
Yep. Thank Generator.
You. Okay. Anything else?
Just want to ask, on these vehicles that we purchase, you know, here we've got a Ford Explorer and a couple of police vehicles, and maybe there'll be a third, so that's four. Do we have any kind of negotiations that go on with a dealership where we're, you know, buying multiple vehicles at a time?
Mr. Kamal.
Yes, we do. We negotiate on many points, including the fact that we buy multiple. We rely on the state bid list, and most importantly, we also negotiate other add-ons to the car as we see appropriate.
And have we settled on one make, Ford, and we stick within that, or is there any negotiation with other brands or some competition that might help us to do better, especially where we're purchasing multiple vehicles?
On that point, my understanding is perhaps 2 years ago, the town did look at two options within the Ford family, either going with the mini SUV or the sedan. I think the decision that has been made is to go with the mini SUV as the preferred option. Chief can speak to why we're sticking with Ford.
No, I mean, I've heard things lately about a lot of dissatisfaction with the current Fords, and sometimes when you look at a couple different manufacturers, they're willing to compete with each other. There are other makes out there. Just asking how we might do better.
So we're in a different situation. Police vehicles, basically the Ford Explorer has the market on police packages now. There's really only one company in the Wigland dealing with that, HQ, who outfit our
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just have one quick one. Last week I was speaking with the governor who was talking about the mass transit and how the mass transit used to go out in their own and buy all their own cement, all their own supplies, and they didn't know that if they just got in on state contracts that they could save a lot of money. And that's where the T saved a lot of money. And I don't know if it's possible to get in on a state contract, so using their buying power, so that we might be able to help the municipality.
As I said, for most of our purchases, we rely on the state bid list.
Okay, great, thank you.
Everybody good? Good, Mrs. Ray?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, school colleagues, everybody good? Any thoughts on these pay-as-you-goes? Good, Mr. Kamalo? You good on the pay-as-you-go list?
Yes, and as I pointed out earlier, we are still in continuing conversations with our colleagues from the school department in terms of any opportunities that we see in this budget, in this capital projects list going forward.
Okay, so what are those conversations? I thought we were passing this tonight, sending it along. I'm confused. It's been a theme lately.
Ms. DeHaan, as we have said, the budget process continues until 2 weeks before town meeting.
That's true.
We will continue to revise our assumptions. We have some numbers in the budget that we still would like to continue to review. For example, we have not certified free cash. We are counting $2.6 million for expenses based on that number being certified. State aid, we are waiting for the three phases of the state government process to complete, and those numbers may change depending on what we are hearing coming from the state.
Okay, so with respect to what we're doing tonight, which is just to pass it to appropriations for their review, we're okay with what we're looking at for now, with the understanding, and I completely agree with what you're saying there, with the understanding that it's still a fluid situation right up into town meeting.
Again, yes, and also contingent on the input that we receive from the proposing entities. I mean, we've said it, this is a very rigorous process. If the school finds opportunities, they'll let us know.
Okay. Everybody good with that?
I'm going to ask a question. So I'm looking at the we had a meeting yesterday, and
yes.
Then some of the email that was exchanged. There's a number on an email that I'm looking at.
Yeah.
Are you asking us to find that number, or are we passing a budget tonight and saying if we can find opportunities in the next couple months?
It's both. I think where we left it yesterday, you had two specific questions. You wanted to know the number. You wanted to know its impact on the tax impact. We have provided that information.
We are also saying why.
This is the time to have the conversation.
Yeah, so the number on the email is $252,000 of additional capital cuts. But I'm
which
not,
the committee didn't receive until 5 minutes before the meeting tonight.
Okay, so, and this is why I was sort of prodding along here, because I knew we had to get to this. So it's the town manager's thought, and I don't want to put thoughts into your head there, but I believe it's the town manager's thought that in order to make the budget work going forward, and what we should be thinking about submitting to appropriations for review would include perhaps 250K of this list not being included. Is that correct? If you had your druthers.
Again,
the whole list.
Yes. My position at this moment is we're looking for opportunities to minimize the tax impact. We are in conversations with the proposing entities. If the proposing entities review the information we we forward it to them and come up with a recommendation. We will discuss that recommendation. I'm taking advantage of the fact that over the years, the town has institutionalized this process where a budget can be passed on to the Appropriations Committee with the understanding that there are issues that can still be worked out. And we were going to continue having that conversation as we've done with all stakeholders in the room.
Okay.
So
can I ask a question
sure.
then?
Go ahead.
The request for the $252,000 is of the entire list of all the facilities under this list, or is it of the school department?
Of the school department. Having answered the question yesterday, on the town side, $692,000 was cut off from DPW. Approximately $100,000 was cut off from facilities.
Can I just ask for clarification? Are you asking us to reduce the pay-as-you-go sheet, or it's the borrowing sheet? I didn't get the email, so I'm not saying no. I'm just wanting to know what list we're looking at. That's all.
Exactly. We're looking at two lists. The majority
combined from both.
Yes. In fact, we can forward the breakdown to Ralph. There's only one project on the borrowing list. The rest of the projects are in the pay-as-you-go free cash list.
Well, the schools have three on the borrowing list.
Sorry?
So that's why I was just asking, which list is it that you're hoping that we can reduce?
There are two lists.
Right.
There's the pay-as-you-go.
Right.
There's also one project that we identified, which I believe we said initially we thought could be paid for through borrowing. We can share that information offline with Ralph and Kathy.
So let me try it from this perspective. We're all here tonight to get it on the table, and now we're getting it on the table.
Yeah.
Okay, and the town manager is suggesting, and I think reasonably so, that we have the discussion anyway, that we want to try and find another $250K in these projects in the pay-as-you-go category. Is that correct, Mr. Kamalo? We're not going to solve that tonight, but this is part of the ongoing discussion. That shouldn't prevent us tonight from saying to our colleagues at the Appropriations Committee, here's what we got so far. We obviously have a little bit more work we're going to be doing between now and then. What do you guys think? And come back to us from their perspective.
Right. So that's what I was trying. So you're talking about pay-as-you-go is where we're looking for a reduction.
Pay-as-you-go is where he is
not
suggesting.
Not necessarily the three on the borrowing.
We're going to get to that in a minute.
Okay.
Right. We haven't got to that sheet yet.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, am I correct to say that of that $256,000, we've already knocked off 110 by taking off the 80 and 30?
Yes.
So we're down to $150,000.
That's not correct.
The answer
is
no.
Yeah, that's not correct.
Yeah.
That was already taken out. That was a typo because we saw that at a meeting yesterday.
Oh.
Okay, so you good?
Is there any difference to anybody else? I mean, I know that there's a difference in longer term impact, but as far as whether it's from pay as you go or whether it's from the operating budget, I'm fine either way. But I think the numbers have to come down. I mean, the impact that we're looking at presenting to the taxpayers in town is crazy this year. Mm-hmm. And I'd hate to see Mr. Herr have to have something that's, you know, requires an override this year. And I know that he doesn't want that. None of us do. and then when we start looking on top of that, we haven't even gotten to the project borrowing sheet, which in my mind is ludicrous at this point in time.
Okay, so let's just table that till we get to
it. But it all has to be brought up together. It's easy to look at one thing and say, yeah.
You want to go home tonight?
I do.
Okay, then just let me work the magic here a little bit, all right? Just stay calm for a couple minutes.
All right, but don't say, does this piece look good? Have everybody say yes. Does this piece look good? Have everybody say yes. And then we get to the end and say, so it sounds like everybody's good with this, but when you look at the whole nut, it's
we're going to have that opportunity too. I'm just trying to clean the room, starting in one
just
corner,
so
and work my way out because it's a mess right now. Yes, I'm sorry. You had a question.
I actually was going to ask the same question about the 110.
Okay. All right.
Sorry about that.
I have a question now. this is obviously I've been through the process a lot, but this is obviously we know this is a unique year. So Mr. Sestari mentioned something about not wanting to go forward with an override. If I'm reading this correctly, are we anywhere near that situation?
Yeah, so I would caution all of us to just stop right now saying the word override. We are not going to do an override. We don't need an override. We wouldn't have to have an override if we put 10% into this thing.
That's how I read
so
it.
I just
wanted to make sure that
I would encourage us just to let that go.
Okay.
There's no way on God's green earth we're doing an override. We don't need to.
Okay.
And one of the reasons we did what we did a few years ago was to build in some wiggle room in the future day, and here we are. So I would just stay away from that, because we'll never get out of here tonight.
I don't think that built-in wiggle room took away wiggle room a couple years ago.
Yes, I understand. Yes and no. Okay. So with the understanding that we're going to come back and perhaps discuss this and we get to the whole concept, let's then move to the capital projects where we're looking at a borrowing. And Mr. Kamala, do you want to share some thoughts on this, and then we'll have some opportunities to talk about individual ones as succinctly as we can. Mr. Kamala.
Yes, several points. The number that you see for the fourth listed project, the new turf fields with lights, is a placeholder.
Can you define what a placeholder means for those not clear?
We were given several numbers to work from, and we simply put in numbers with the understanding that that number could be refined as the budget process unfolds.
Okay.
There's an active subcommittee working that the school committee has established to look at this, the potential of this project, and so they have not yet presented back any proposal to the school committee. So this is on there right now as a placeholder pending the recommendation of that committee, so we don't have a hard number yet.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's do this. Let's start at the top of the list, if we could. I'll read it out, and if you've got a thought or concern or question, please let us know. Fire station, rooftop HVAC unit, $500,000. These would all be borrowings, so they're all going to add to that debt service a little bit. Nothing like the magnitude of what we've got, but they would add to it. Hearing no takers. Elmwood School Solution, $300,000.
In fact, we will be adjusting this number to read as $600,000, though with the understanding that depending on the conversations with the MSBA, the MSBA may be paying 50% of that.
Okay, Mr. Catino had a question. What is that? Can someone explain to us what the Elmwood School Solution $600,000 request is?
So I can, but it's on the agenda for later tonight. I don't know if you want me to do it now as part of this.
I'd keep it at 30,000 feet for right now.
30,000 feet. On the agenda for the Board of Selectmen tonight is to consider a vote to have a submission, have the schools submit for a statement of interest with the MSBA for a potential Elmwood School Solution based on enrollment projections. The decision or the conversations that we've had at special town meeting, that people have been asking, what are we doing about enrollment beyond the center school solution or the replacement to center school? And knowing that if we're talking about a 10-year projection, we need to start thinking now about what that might mean 5 years from now. So it's really just beginning, getting in line. We don't know if we'll be invited in, but even just making submitting the statement of interest, which is due by the end of April, to get in line to be considered for MSBA assistance.
So similar to the Center School Solution Project, this would represent basically feasibility.
Correct.
And so, as you know, with the MSBA process, we don't know when we're going to be invited in, but you sort of have to be sitting on go.
Yeah.
And so we wanted to get this into the warrant so that we would, much like we did with the center school, be prepared if and when we would be allowed in.
So is it a $600,000 ante to get on the list? I'm just trying to figure out where this.
No.
Oh, this is up to the study.
It's about what feasibility would cost.
Oh, okay.
And yeah. So, but they would reimburse roughly 50%. I mean, depending on our percentage, 50% of it.
And none of it would be spent unless we're invited in.
Right.
Any other questions on the Elmwood School Solution? Air conditioning at middle school auditorium, $250,000.
In fact, Mr. Chair, I believe that number is $162,000.
That's correct.
Yeah.
$162,000 for the air conditioning unit. Okay. New turf fields, let's come back to that one. Salt shed subsurface, $260,000, the highway department.
What's that all about?
Mr. Westerling,
yes,
30,000 feet, please.
30,000 feet. We found older fields.
under where the new salt shed is being proposed that didn't allow us to put in the rigid inclusions because they had to be drilled in. So what we had to do was to excavate out all the bad material, bring in good material. If we don't get this money, we'll have to take from other things integral to the design, such as security fencing, handicap push button for doors, painting in the garage, canopy over the fuel island. So this is really essential to keep the project whole.
Thank you. Good? For now?
For now.
Okay, so keep in mind, these are sort of outside regular budget, and these are capital items that would be debt excluded. Design and construction phase 2 5-year capital sidewalk plan, $1.8 million. No takers?
Yeah, I'd love to hear what that's all about too.
Mr. Westerling, 30,000 feet, please.
30,000 feet through you, Mr. Chairman. This is the next phase of sidewalks, which were proposed by the planning board. And what we are doing is constructing 500 feet of sidewalk on Wood Street, 4,200 feet of sidewalk on West Main Street, which would run from Lumber Street down past Price Chopper, 3,800 feet of sidewalk on Hayden Row on the easterly side to accommodate the new school, and a short portion of 200 feet on Wild Road.
Okay, so it's part of a plan that they've been working on for years to get more sidewalks in town. Okay, for now. Vehicle multi-purpose municipal tractor. It looks like we pulled that. Mr. Kamal?
CIC recommended approval. Town manager is not recommending this for FY18.
Mr. Westerling?
Through you, Mr. Chairman. As part of the reevaluating our capital request, this is one of the items that we believe that we can live without until perhaps next year.
Okay. Mr. Tedstone.
Mr. Westerling, what is that vehicle multi-purpose municipal tractor specifically?
Through you, Mr. Chairman, we currently have two trackless machines, which we use primarily in the wintertime to plow and snowblow sidewalks. Right now, with just those two, it takes us up to 8 to 11 hours to clear the sidewalks. So with the expanding length of sidewalk that we're being asked to clear, we would like to have a third unit so that we could cut down on that amount of time, which would help the schools to open on time. It would open up the sidewalks to pedestrian safety more quickly.
So that $160,000 is a sidewalk plow, snowblower.
It's a multi-purpose machine.
And it also has the flail mower on it. Okay, all right.
Thank you. And then returning back up, staying inside the general debt fund, general fund debt service items. The turf field with lights. Would someone at the schools like to share? I mean, I'm on that committee. I'm a liaison to that committee from the Board of Selectmen and a bunch of meetings. But would someone like from the school committee just kind of want to share what's going on with that?
Yeah, I can give a quick update. So we do have a subcommittee that involves a lot of people across the community, as well as participation from a lot of different boards, including Appropriations, Board of Selectmen, Parks and Rec. So, as John said, they're not at a final proposal at this point. This is actually a higher number than what I've seen, but we've had two feasibility studies done. What we're looking at is a phased approach to add two turf fields on fields 4 and 5, and then followed a few years later by a project on the at the football field. So right now, what the timeline, should it go forward this year, we wouldn't break ground before the spring of 2018. So I actually don't think that there would be an impact to the FY18 budget. If so, it would probably be amenable. It would really start in the FY19. So I can answer any questions that you have, but I think what the most important thing that I would like to leave you with is there's still a lot of work going on in the subcommittee. We're working really collaboratively with CPC, with Conservation Commission, with Parks and Rec, and so We know that this is a big number, and we know that this is a tough year, and it's something that we will absolutely be continuing to look at and may very well be postponed at some point down the road. But right now, we haven't discussed it as a committee. I would advocate for keeping this where it is for the moment and continuing to take a hard look at the process, what the options are for offsets in terms of CPC funding and private funding and all of that. It continued to and revisit it again closer to town meeting, where I mean, you can always pull it off. In that vein, you know, in addition, whatever considerations you have, that you know, questions that we can investigate if we aren't already doing so, absolutely love to hear those. But and again, I'm happy to answer any questions, but in the spirit of time, I don't want to just launch into a big diatribe. I would advocate for just leaving it where it is for right now and continuing to look at it.
Okay, so the items on this list, including that field discussion, are all items that are outside the 3.87% potential tax impact, correct, Mr. Kamal?
It depends whether we'd be paying any interest in FY18.
Maybe a slight budget impact.
If something were to go quickly, okay. But by and large, they're outside the general operating budget and the pay-as-you-go budget that we've already spent most of the evening on.
That's correct. It won't significantly impact.
And frankly, town meeting is going to make the decision on these items more than anybody else because they're going to separate articles. Does everybody understand where that is?
Can I ask a question on the turf fields?
Yeah.
If the turf fields, will this turf field, is the goal of this new turf field to eliminate or to correct the problem that we had last year with the grounds?
Actually, that's a great question. And Dr. McLeod, I'm going to let her answer it better. But I do want to say we have added into our operating budget additional monies to have improved maintenance of our natural fields. And as part of the work of the subcommittee, we are looking at sort of the new athletic director and principal are doing a revised master plan of what sports may be played on what fields and what natural fields we need to improve. And actually, you have the RFP information and whatnot, but it is part of the work that the subcommittee is doing.
So, Dr. McLeod, as we know, the schools are kind of the flagship. That's what draws most people to Hopkinton. I've been around Hopkinton for quite a while. Many, many generations of my family has been in Hopkinton. The schools are incredible. And I thank you, from the bottom of my heart, I thank you. What a wonderful job everyone there has done keeping the schools where it is. The grounds of the school are embarrassing. The fact, the tennis courts, the area where the water towers are, the fact that the high school, the kids that were seniors of the high school last year had to play games in another town because our fields weren't playable, it's embarrassing. And an 80 or however many dollar budget that you have, if we can't get fertilizer and seed to take care of the weeds, that's our flagship. And to drive up and say, look at that beautiful school, it is embarrassing. And Elmwood School is in the same ridiculous, embarrassing condition than when I was a fourth grader there. So that's not a reflection of you. But the grounds themselves, for the amount of money that we spend towards a school, the reason that my house is worth X amount of dollars here and $150,000 less in Upton is because of our schools.
So it most certainly is a reflection of me and the work that I know has to happen around grounds. That's why we have a plan in place. Mm-hmm. I was as embarrassed about the situation, unacceptable situation last year with our fields. That's why we have a grounds maintenance plan in place for this year, because it became very clear that we did not have enough maintenance people to maintain to the level that it needs to be maintained,
mm-hmm.
to include the fields and the buildings.
Mm-hmm.
We have not only a maintenance plan for the natural turf, but also for the irrigation system, mm-hmm. because what I learned last summer was that it took one person pretty much their entire summer just to maintain the irrigation system, which again meant that the fields were not getting the attention. So I agree with everything that you just said. There's one thing I'm confused about from what you said, however, and that is the tennis courts, because they were just resurfaced.
Not the tennis courts, but the grounds around the tennis courts.
Absolutely.
You know, they're mowing weeds, they're not mowing grass.
You are absolutely right. And so yep. this is definitely something that has become a priority of mine personally since the situation last spring.
Mm-hmm.
So we do have a plan in place. And interestingly enough, this is exactly why the football field is phase two of the proposed discussion that we've been having, because one of the things we learned was that we really could get a few more years out of the track. Mm-hmm. And if we were to look at replacing the football field now, we really would be not capitalizing on work we've already done. So one thing that would be useful to the Board of Selectmen would be to have the subcommittee, the school committee subcommittee, come and do a presentation to give you detailed feedback and information on where they are, because they've done a tremendous amount of work, and as Jean says, there's much to be done. But I thank you and appreciate your comments, and am taking them very seriously.
Dr. McLeod, roughly how much of an increase are we looking at in maintenance this year, trying to improve the fields and get them back up to par?
I believe it was, I wouldn't quote me on it, but it's in the realm of 30,000.
But can I add that we reduced a position? So when you ask about the increase, it was more of a reallocation.
Okay.
So there definitely was an increase to maintenance, but we also, as we always do, we always look at what things we can stop doing when we're talking about what we're going to start doing. That's always the first lens that we have. And one of the things that we did is we reduced a 0.5 position, because we're going to be hiring outside experts to come in and help us maintain. So we said, you know what, if we're going to do that, we're going to reduce a 0.5 position, and that helped to fund.
So I guess if we can get outside experts,
correct.
Who I would assume are proven in their capabilities in that area,
yes.
and it's at pricing like that, even if we got more aggressive and tried to make them even nicer natural fields,
yeah.
wouldn't it make sense to give that a few years before we start proposing $1 million and $4 million fields at town meeting?
So you're Let's not asking the expert now on this, but I think that would be a great question, you know, to bring to the committee, or maybe John has the answer.
I was going to say, I do think that would be, I think the subcommittee would want to address that. I think the one of the things we said when we first launched the subcommittee, that the turf fields are solving a potentially different problem. You can have the most well-maintained fields, but we live in Massachusetts. And so the availability of those fields is, when they're grass fields, is a lot less than their turf fields, as an example. I don't necessarily think because we will be coming back and discussing this if we leave this warrant article on to move forward based on the recommendation of the subcommittee, I would look forward to a very detailed discussion about why this is happening or why this is being proposed with the subcommittee. But I think trying to get us to answer a lot of these questions when we've brought in a lot of experts from the town, and we have, not surprisingly, more resources from the town who are experts in this kind of work than we ever would have known, is probably not going to be a hugely productive conversation tonight. I'm not trying to avoid it. I'm just trying to make sure we have it at the time when we have all the information.
Well, I just want to say, I understand it's a placeholder. I understand there are people putting a lot of time into it. With every single one of these requests, there's a rationale behind it, and sometimes very good reasons. But regardless of that, the optics on this are terrible. Mm-hmm. I don't care how it's paid for, where it's paid for. It completely flies in the face right now of the challenges we as a town and the boards have before us, and everything we've been saying tonight about trying to squeeze everything out of every nickel. it comes across, I think, as an insult to the taxpayers and a slap in the face to people who are struggling and really being challenged with the taxes. And if you look further down the line, our revenues that we've been getting from permits and new construction are tapering off. We're having a hard time living within our means with what we have right now. And that income stream is going to stop. And I just think that the optics on this are wrong, and I think it's very ill-advised.
So we're not going to debate the merits of this field thing tonight because we don't even have nearly the time to do so. But I would counter your argument and say I've heard nothing but nonstop support for putting in turf fields. So it depends on who we talk to. You know, so I understand where you're coming from, and I certainly understand some of the folks that you're chatting with and that weigh in on these issues. Other people are weighing in with me and weighing in with other people as well and weighing in with them. So without debating the merits of the fields, because it's a big topic and it's a big number, I think we need to try and move on now. But there's many people out there that are extremely frustrated that we're not doing this immediately because their kids are playing on fields that have holes in them.
And I would add that there are certain segments, and then there's the town as a whole, which is made up of a variety of ages, a variety of income levels.
I'm keenly aware of how you measure the whole town. I understand that.
We represent them all.
So with that, Mr. Kamal, I interrupted you as you were walking us through the budget earlier. We've done the operating. We've done the pay-as-you-go. We've done the capital debt service, if you will. There is also enterprise funds numbers here, which would be covered in the enterprise funds themselves, whether it be debt service or capital purchase. Does anybody have any thoughts on these enterprise fund issues or assets, if you will?
Again, the idea here was to move forward in FY18 with projects that are absolutely necessary and needed. To continue to provide for the appropriate water and sewer servicing levels. We have also said, thanks to the townspeople, the ratepayers, we are completing a business study, which we would like to use as the basis for identifying any future projects that fall under water and sewer.
All of which are covered through water and sewer enterprise funds.
Right, yes.
So they're outside the general funds, they're outside the typical debt service numbers, and they're inside the enterprise funds for those particular businesses in town. Does anybody have any specific questions about these? Okay, hearing none, and those will all get fully vetted between now and town meeting anyway as a separate article. Mr. Kamal, what else did you want to say specific in your presentation to the board and to our colleagues about the budget overall?
Just one more capital project. through the joint efforts of the school committee and the Board of Selectmen, we are continuing our planning and design for a traffic calming solution on Hayden Row. We have begun the public consultation process. We are hoping to have a recommendation ready in advance of town meeting. So we will be coming back to the Board of Selectmen to present that project for consideration.
Okay. All right. So now let's try and pull it all together to Mr. Sestari's point earlier. 3.87% tax impact. If we do what we've outlined so far, or we keep what we've outlined so far, 3.87% tax impact. If we keep the pay-as-you-go as it is, if we bring that down, the 3.87% will come down. And then we've got capital articles outside that, including the fields, which is obviously a big one that's going to stir a lot of passion in town. But any thoughts about the overall budget and any thoughts about the Board of Selectmen voting to forward the recommended town budget from the town manager's office to the Appropriations Committee for their review, with the understanding that this is a work in progress. We're still having some dialogue with various department heads about specific article or capital items as well as potential articles that stand alone.
Mr. Chair, I'm relatively new at this process, but how I see it, I have a hard time putting my stamp of approval on this, knowing that there's such a wide range in numbers. Like, how can we say it's
define stamp of approval for me, please.
I have a hard time saying I'm okay with passing it on to the next.
So let's do this then. Let's have Mr. Kamala walk us through the steps in the budget from tonight forward and see if that helps some of your concern. Mr. Kamala.
If the selectmen are inclined to move the budget to the Appropriations Committee, the committee proactively has scheduled individual meetings with different departments in town. They will be reviewing the budget specifically with regard to two areas. They continue to review the expenditures that are proposed, and most importantly, they engage with staff on the funding options to support the requested expenditures. This is a process that continues, concluding with a public hearing. I believe there's a tentative date that has been put forth for that public hearing. The goal is to complete the process at least 2 weeks before town meeting.
Okay. Does this, when the Appropriations Committee, they get something tonight, let's say they get something tonight, and they start working on it, and then they put it all together from their perspective, do they then send it back to the town manager's office or to the Board of Selectmen for a final review before it goes to town meeting?
In fact, based on past practice, they do not wait until they complete the process. If they identify an issue that could be addressed immediately, they settle back to the town manager and to the selectmen for a joint conversation before they make their final adjustment.
And when they make their final adjustment, does it then come back to us before it goes to town meeting, or does it go straight to town meeting? So is he going to get another bite at the apple? Because right now he's not comfortable with these numbers.
He will get another bite at the apple.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino?
I'm okay.
Mrs. Wright?
Okay.
Mr. Sestari?
Mr. Kamala, what's the new growth number that's in here again?
New growth is approximately 2.1 million.
2.1 million. Check.
Yeah, hold 1 second. I'll tell you in 1 second.
Yeah, 2.1.
Yep. Is that something that we expect to repeat year over year, or does that disappear next year or the following year?
My estimation is that as soon as we conclude the legacy permitting process, that number will go back to the pre-legacy levels, which were around 400,000 and 500,000.
Okay. So basically, this number that we're looking at here, just for reference, just a straight 2.5% without using excess levy capacity, a straight 2.5% is around 1.4 million. Is that correct?
Correct.
So right now we're absorbing with excess levy capacity about $800,000, but we're also absorbing about another $1.5 million from this new growth in terms of what will be repeated. So when we're looking at this and saying that we're staying under 2.5%, we're not staying under 2.5%.
Not at all.
We're staying under it in the legal definition in terms of we've got excess levy capacity and we can, you know, throw that on. And this is what led us to having the underwrite a few years ago when we looked and we basically did the math out and we were saying we could have, you know, an 8% increase on someone's taxes directly, but it would magically fall underneath that 2.5% level, mm-hmm. which is deceiving because most people don't see that, they don't understand it. When we add this $1.5 million in there too, you know, I'm not saying we're being deceitful because we're not, we're trying to keep it out in the open and make sure that people understand. But nonetheless, the bottom line is these numbers are increasing at far too rapid a rate. And it may be something where, you know, you have the excess levy capacity that's absorbing more of this. You've got the new growth that's absorbing $2 million of this. And all of a sudden, in not next year, but the year after, people are going to get slapped in the face with that. And added on top of that, not just the teachers' contracts, but any contracts that we're negotiating, and we have all these different projects that have been approved, you know, whether it's a new DPW building, the new library, new school, you know, possibly looking at a new turf field and things like that. None of this is trivial. And you know, I know that we have a duty to kind of, I'll say, kick the can over to appropriations, because that's basically what we're doing. If we say, yeah, we're okay with moving to the next step here with this budget, you know, it's putting an awful heavy load on them if we expect them to work with us and with the schools and with everybody else to whittle that number down to a point, at least in my mind, that's acceptable to and respectable to hand off to town meeting. I think this number has to come down. I think we need commitment from everybody at these tables that we're gonna continue to try to get these numbers down. I mean, it's crazy.
But if I may, through the chair, I have people coming up to me saying, seeing the $2.1 million coming in, and say, why aren't my taxes going down?
Yeah.
And and it just gets scary, because if you look at 2020, you know, it's down to 1.3. 2021 down to 900,000. This is all estimates. In 2022, it's down to $500,000 in new growth. And there are people that don't want new growth in the town, saying, you know, I moved in here, pull up the drawbridge, I don't want anybody else coming in, but not knowing that without new growth, that there is that's the only thing that offsets some of these tax increases.
And the irony of all this is that if we were to pass this through right now, our excess levy capacity goes up next year. It doesn't even come down. So, you know, that's kind of crazy.
Mr. Kamalu, or Chris, or whomever, isn't there a $500,000
allowance for abatements? Is that what you...
Nope.
Oh, sorry.
For the amount of students that are coming in from Legacy, isn't there a $500,000? Once they hit a certain amount of students, doesn't that a one-time payment of $500,000?
We're not even close, and we're not going to hit it. I mean, the student growth is coming from all over town. It's not, Legacy is not exceeding
okay.
in any measurable way what their projections were.
We monitor it very carefully.
Yep. I was just wondering. That's $1,000 is
right.
Good chunk of change that would help us out, but.
Definitely.
The key drivers to this budget at 40,000 feet are contractual obligations. We can't break the contract. It is what it is. It is about $500,000 between additional personnel and some this additional type of instruction for special education, right? Because it was about, you guys were $1.2 million and $500,000, it was $1.7 million. And it is debt service on these three massive projects that we are putting in. If we didn't have this debt service, we would have been out of here at 8:30. This debt service with a 55% increase is, quote, killing the budget. But town meeting in the last 3 years said, build a DPW facility. It's going to be a great asset for the community. We will get a return on investment of that asset, but we got to buy it. Town meeting said, build a new elementary school for $30 million, whatever the price tag is for the town. It's going to be a great asset for the community. We will get a return on investment of that asset, but we got to pay for it. And town meeting said, build a library. And we've worked at that for many years because we couldn't figure out funding for that. And we're going to get a return on investment on that. But with all due respect, and I'm sure people say, get them off the board. Our hands are tied this year. There's not a whole heck of a lot we can do. We either violate contracts, we tell people stop construction, or we don't pay the construction loans.
Or you cut in other areas.
What do you cut?
You know, I'm just saying, there's, you know, those aren't the only aspects of the budget. You know, there is.
Do we cut trash service?
It's, you know, maybe that's what you have to consider. All I'm saying is that, you know, there are more components of the budget than just those key drivers.
But those, you know, three drivers are amount for 95% of our problem. If you cut trash, okay, you're going to pick up $100,000. Mm-hmm. We need to pick up millions.
Well, you know, I mean, to Mr. Tedstone's point earlier, and I'm not suggesting this right now, so I don't want people to jump on me.
But, you know, maybe it's something where, you know, you cut teachers, or maybe you cut down the road maintenance, or, you know, cut the trash pickup, you know, whatever. There are a lot of different components. Maybe it's employees at town hall. There are a lot of different components to the budget that can make up that differential. And, you know, it's easy for people to vote and say, yeah, I want a new library, or yeah, I want a new school. And it's definitely things that help make our town, you know, what it is, helps bring us up to the next level. But, you know, there's also a cost associated with that. And I don't feel confident personally that when we're at town meeting, people really recognize the full impact and the impact going forward.
I agree, and that's part of the problem, frankly. We could have spaced some of this stuff out, I think, but we didn't. And so we are where we are. And I've been a strong advocate over the years for cutting wherever we can. If we start cutting personnel out of the new library, why are we building a new library? If we take teachers out of the classroom, why are we building new classrooms? I mean, we just voted to build, we're adding classrooms. Why would we do that? I get it, but it doesn't make sense. I really think our hands are tied this time. And that's the first time I think I've said this in the 10 years I've been doing this job. I think our hands are tied.
Can I just make a comment on this? That I've been involved, on the appropriations for 5-6 years now, and I've been seeing this, and, you know, and at town meeting, I have been saying this is all going to come. You know, we don't start paying the taxes on it until the projects are finished. Unfortunately, they're all completing in the same year. And we've been asked what is going to be the impact of this. You know, we didn't have exact numbers until now because we're not servicing the debt. But my estimate was going to be, if you did it all in 1 year, it was going to be a 10% increase on an impact if we got it all in 1 year. So the fact that this year we're getting about 75% of the debt service on these three big projects in 1 year, and the fact that we can manage to keep it at 3.87%, because I thought it was going to be 6 or 7%, I think it was actually an amazing job. And next year, it's going to be like a 1 million increase. So I expected it to be much higher than it is. And the fact that we've been doing all this cost saving this year and trying to smooth out the impact, that this year is 3.87 or 3.8, and next year, I still don't understand, you know, the model for next year, that it's still 4%. This is something I'm going to work on, you know, in the next couple of weeks. But the fact that once we absorb the impact of this debt, it's in the budget. We're not going to see these increases unless we keep on taking on new big capital projects, you know.
But if you take out that new growth, we are up over 6% too on this year.
For this year, next year, and we're absolutely fortunate that I think, what was it, 1.2 million, 1.4 million last year for the new growth, and this year we're able to take $2.1 million. That's why we're getting it down to 3.8%, which is kind of a blessing to the taxpayers, just because it would have been that much higher.
Remember that one of the things that people are screaming about is they've said enough new growth, we want to slow things down. So, you know, that doesn't help the future.
Another issue that, I mean, it's nothing that anyone here can do, but at town meeting, we have 150 people generally. It's the same 150 people that come up to the town meeting when we have 16,000 people in town. If the people that come up to me and say, I can't believe we built a new library, I can't believe we're building a new DPW, it was good enough for Cook-Hamlin, it's good enough today. Well, where were you at town meeting? If you know, it's one of those things. You don't like Donald Trump. If you didn't vote, you don't have anything to say. So it doesn't have any reflection on how we're going to manage the budget, but it's easy to sit back, let things go, and then when things don't go well, to throw pot shots at it rather than take part of the process. So if 1,000 people that sat home that are now saying, I can't believe we have a new DPW garage, if they came up and voted against it, then maybe we wouldn't have had it. But that's neither here nor there. You know, that's kind of just something that, as the people that come up to me and complain and complain and complain, I said, I was at the last town meeting, I didn't see you there. Were you there? Well, no, I didn't make it. Okay, well, then.
So with that, and also with, acknowledgement, first of all, it's our collective responsibility to try to make these presentations as clear as possible and make sure that that 150, 200 people who are there understand the full impact, and they can see 10 years down the road what the impact of the taxes are. And I think we're doing a much better job than we were, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, and we're presenting a lot more information. But it's also this group's collective responsibility, in my opinion, to be presenting something that is responsible.
Yep.
And, you know, it's not always, you know, we can't put candy in front of our kids and say, you know, do you want this? You know, well, yeah, you know, the kid wants candy. But, you know, so maybe whether it's, you know, the third cruiser that may not be needed, and if it's not needed for safety, then we should cut off the third cruiser, or whether it's a turf field or whatever, we need to look at this and say, okay, this year, is this something that's responsible to present, or is it our fiduciary responsibility to keep it off the docket so that, you know, we don't have a chance to shoot ourselves in the foot?
Agreed.
I agree. Okay, so, you know, I think there's frustration. I feel it. I mean, this is a very frustrating process this year because we're not in control as much of it, I think, as we have in the past. But with that, it is what it is. I think we got to try and keep the process moving forward. I hope the town manager agrees. And I would suggest that we take what we've discussed tonight, Appropriations Committee, a couple are here anyway, have heard all of it, and forward it to them for review. And then we'll get that next bite at the apple here in a few weeks or a month or so down the road and see where we wind up. But with the understanding that we have to keep this dialogue open and we got to keep working together on any and all items that we can find to ease the burden, and also understand that, you know, maybe we will have a huge groundswell of folks at town meeting. That would be the best thing that could come of this whole situation, is for a lot of people to come out and say what's going on and sort of understand how it works. You know, it's a tough way to learn the lesson, but that would be a good, I think that would be a good outcome for this process. But I do think we got to keep the process moving forward. So, anybody have any other thoughts, comments, questions? With that, the chair will entertain a motion to submit to the Appropriations Committee the town manager's budget recommendations to date for their review and feedback to the Board of Selectmen.
Mr. Chair, before we entertain any motion of that sort, I would like to get some type of a formal commitment. And I know that this doesn't bind anybody to anything, but I'd like to get a formal commitment from the Board of Selectmen as well as the school committee to continue looking for substantive cuts that we can make, whether it's in the capital budget, operating budget, and try to trim this budget down some more.
Okay, so in the pay-as-you-go budget, capital budget, and the operating budget, right? Okay.
Yeah. I think that we all still have a responsibility on the other borrowing budget, but to your point, that's something that, you know, we don't have a lot of say. You know, we have, each one of us has just as much say as everybody else at town meeting. Of course, I know that that's true for the budgets too, but
yeah,
at a more granular level.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll table my suggested motion for a minute and have this discussion. So is there any way that we can come to some agreement as to what we're going to shoot for a target? Are you trying to set a number here?
You know, I mean, we tried setting targets back when we were putting out a budget message, and that wasn't well received. You know, I just hope that everybody here can be sensitive to all the taxpayers in town, not just supporters of, you know, one particular area or another. But, you know, we need to do what's financially responsible to the best of our ability. And I know that there's, you know, we all have multiple responsibilities, and keeping the schools, you know, on an upward trend is one of them. You know, keeping the roads, you know, smooth and clear and all that is another. But this is something where we really need to start looking at all of this and see what we can do for the taxpayer directly.
Okay. Anybody have any thoughts? Suggestions? It's still kind of open-ended, I think, in general.
It is. And you know, again, you know, I know that when we were trying to put numbers down during the budget message, you know, that was a difficult conversation, and it wasn't going anywhere. And it's all non-binding anyway. But, you know, I think that whether it's cutting, you know, And whether it's cutting $200,000 off or whether, you know, whether we say a half a percent or whatever, in the end, it's really up to the individual committees and the individuals themselves to make that effort and try to stick to the commitment and meet the commitment. But in the end, if they don't, then, you know, nothing's going to be said or done. So
basically what I hear you saying, and correct me if I'm wrong, is you're messaging, you know, back to what we started the budget process with, which we need to go through a year or two of austerity, where we've got to shut it all down and not go with three cruisers, go with one. And not go with $1.8 million where the sidewalks go with $180,000. And not going with, you know, whatever. I mean, all across the board, shut it all down. Because you either shut it all down or you fund things that you're investing in.
Well, that's what we used to do to you, Mr. Chairman. When you were on the board about 5 years ago, I remember one time you were at a meeting and said, we're not going over 2.5. And we came in at like 2.47 or something. And we're able to do that. But that's exactly what ended up happening. We ended up putting off a bunch of projects and we stayed under those numbers. And I think we do have to really look at these things and decide what's absolutely necessary. If the, you know, if the contracts are going up 1.3 and then the other stuff goes up 1.7 in the school budgets and the police budgets and the fire budgets and town hall go up, you know, we have those nuts that can't move. But to Mr. Starry's point, we might have to put off some of these things that are nice to have.
Well, we got to pay the debt service or we stop the construction. Does everybody agree with that?
Right.
I mean, if we want to get right down to the brass tacks here, if we're going to build these buildings, we got to pay the debt service. We've got contracts in place for public safety, DPW, across the communities, teachers, everybody. Those contracts are in place. We're either paying our employees or we're going to lay people off. Okay? So that's if we're going to keep that going, then really you're going to come down to some, you know, pretty low-hanging fruit that's going to add up to maybe $1 million. And that $1 million is going to be, instead of 3.87%, let's say you took that million out, you're looking at 2.5. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we got to find $1 million if you want to get to 2.5.
Can I say something?
Sure.
So I was building budgets for the school committee right after that override. And the reason we were able to not lay off staff is we cut some programs, but we also instituted fees. Now, I think there's been a trend in town to get rid of those fees, but we're looking at trying to cut expenses. Maybe we should also be looking at how we increase the revenue to balance those expenses. So something to think about is you're only focusing on one end of the equation right now.
So is the $1 million your target?
You said that number, not me. Is that your preferred target,
well
Mr.
played,
Chair?
Mr. Sestari. I don't know if that's exactly 2.5. I mean, we don't have to be exact.
1.4 million is 2.5%. 1.4 million is a 2.5% increase. So, you know, if you're taking a million, then that's what,
it's
2/3.
So
it's.
I don't think it would need to be 500. If you want to get to 2.5 total net impact, including new growth, you're looking at, so let's say we're at 4, just to keep it simple. You need 1.5. So that's 750K, roughly. Because it's 50 million is the levy. Okay, so 500 is 1. So 1.5 is 750.
Yeah, I think you guys are just looking at numbers, and what we have to look at to Claire's point is we have to look at specific projects like the field. That'll never go through this year.
But that's not in that number.
It's not in that number. No, but I'm saying, but even looking at some of these other things, are there some things that people will say, geez, yeah, they really did tighten their budget. They really did tighten their belt. You know, I'm glad they pulled in here, pulled in there. Even if we pulled it down that $252,000 that Mr. Kamau was looking for one place, and then, you know, a couple hundred thousand from another place. We're doing our job as opposed to just rubber stamping, but then pushing back on a few things.
So I personally think the field should go before town meeting, whether it's this year, next year, whenever they go, and let the citizens make that decision. It's a big price tag. It's an emotional question. Some people
Mr.
are...
Mr. Herr, we're not talking about the borrowing budget. We're talking about the operating budget and the pay-as-you-go.
Right, and that's what I'm going to say. So we should just table that. It should just go before town meeting. Let them figure it out, okay? Because there's going to be as many people at the microphone yelling for them as we'll be yelling against them. Specific to this year, the operating budget and pay-as-you-go, if you want to get to 2.5 net impact, bottom line, we need $750,000 extracted from this budget, period. So the motion could be we send it to the Appropriations Committee with the understanding that between now and town meeting, not necessarily their role, but our collective role is to find another $750,000 and take it out of the budget. Would that be procedurally okay, Mr. Kamal?
I think procedurally, I think the board can decide to go that way. I'm already thinking about the first conversation that I need to have with everybody else around this room. I think the question is going to be asked, why 750,000?
2.5. It gets us to roughly 2.5%.
Okay. That's one way to look at it.
And that's an approximate number, so we'll play with that a little bit. But if you want to set a hard line at 2.5% net of new growth, then that's the magnitude you're looking at.
Yeah.
And I think it's because people, you know, in real life, in industry, and I know that where I work now, I had to get under my budget. I had to cut some of my full-time employees and make them part-time and cut all their hours and instead of laying people off. Just to stay under my budget, and I think people are feeling this in their homes, that the stuff is happening to them at their work and everything else, and I think that we have to do the same thing here. Whether it's 750, a million, 500,000, let's I think we have to do the best we can, and push it off another year or two. You did a great job with it 5 years ago when we put off some stuff, and it was tough because when we had to come back to it, we had to really invest. It's like the sidewalks.
5 years ago, though, the scenario, there was two different things. The economy was different than it is today. Not that it's rocking and rolling for everybody. I get that. And two, we set the limit so that there wouldn't be new spending. What we're talking about doing now is, in my opinion, we've made investments as a community, and now we're not going to fully fund those investments in the ways they should be funded. Whether it be how we staff the new school, how we staff the library, you know, what we're doing with the police force, we added personnel to the police force in the last year. I mean, all these things that we've done, we're now going to be cutting into that a little bit. And if that's what we have to do, that's what we have to do. I get it. But everybody has to understand the difference then and now is that stopped spending. This cuts spending because the contractual obligations, the debt service, you know, those numbers kill all that new stuff if that's the philosophy we're going to take. And I get it. I hear you 100%. Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, it's very painful when you look at one particular thing and say we're going to take it out of this or we want this department to take it. But even your whole operating budget, what if you went to each section of that budget and you said, cut it down by 1%, penny on the dollar. Try to take each single element and take 1% off, which is probably not going to hurt that much. By the time you get down to the bottom, you're talking some real money.
The problem is the union contracts.
No, I'm talking about the things that you can take money out of.
You won't.
You know, operating budgets for.
You won't get for 750 grand.
Well, you might get something that would be worth. Take, I mean, you know, you ask for a small reduction in each area that, you know, at the end of the day, you've got a chunk of change. Maybe it won't be where you want to be, but it might be demonstrative of, you know, everybody tightening the belt a little bit for the general objective of the town's well-being.
If we did 1% on non-contractual, non-construction, non-debt service stuff, like the things mm-hmm. that we... You know, we're obligated
everything
to pay.
Everything that's in that.
You're
yeah.
probably looking at 80% of 80 million, so it's 16. You're probably looking at 160 grand.
At 1%?
At 1%.
Of non-contractual?
Of non-obligated stuff.
So make it 7%.
Well, the point, Don, again, is to take a small amount off of everything. A small
amount. The 1% doesn't get to where he's talking about, which is he wants 2.5.
Well, okay. You
I didn't say that. You said that, Mr. Hart.
That's your word. Behind
I never
it
said
is,
that.
You ask
no,
everything.
That was, I said that's what we did. Well,
that was arbitrary, too. It's great. But the idea is, you know, you take a little bite out of every single thing.
Okay. So, but we're having...
might get some real money out of it.
We're having a circular argument with ourselves. We're either going to name a number that we want to get to, or we're going to have the same discussion that we had 3 months ago saying, do your best. And if we do the best, we're going to have a circular argument the next time we get together. If we say it's 750 grand because we want to get to 2.5%, go make it happen. Yeah, that stinks. That puts a lot of pressure on people. We're going to make it happen. We can't say, let's do 1% and see what happens.
So 3 months ago when you were arguing for us to just say, do your best, that was okay, but now it's not.
That's correct.
Okay. Just wanted to get that straight.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Feel good? So what are we going to do?
Cut your budget by 7%.
No, I'll make a motion that we go to get it to 3%. That's
the difference. To get you halfway there.
Set the net of new growth budget impact, though, higher than 3%.
Higher than 3%.
So that's a point, roughly. It's not quite a point. So it'll be about $440,000. I would like to set a number, to your point, okay?
I think it's better to have a goal.
I do, too. Well, that's why I was asking.
I'm busting your chops, but... You know, okay. I mean, it's certainly better to have a number, otherwise...
This is where we were before. This is where we were a few months.
That's why I'm pushing for a number.
And I'll make a motion at 3%.
Well, I want a
second.
Let's hang on a sec. Mr. Kamalo, okay, so we have a motion and a second, so discussion. Mr. Kamalo, if we're at 3.87, what's if we take it to 3? That's 0.87 on, what's the levy, 50 what?
Are you looking for the dollar equivalent of...
I'm looking for the levy on the residents, so it's 60. It's 62.54. 62.544 times 545,000. That would be the number if you use the tax levy that's proposed, right, Chris? That's 62.5 is the tax levy proposed. So if you're going to back out of that to get to 3%, you take 0.87% of that. So that's on the taxpayer, okay? And that takes us to take out $545,000. So there's a motion on the table and a second at 3%. Which is equivalent to extracting $545,000 from the operating and pay-as-you-go capital budgets. Is that in your motion?
That's my motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All right? So we're all here together. I'd like to hear from our school colleagues and appropriations about this because we're all in it together. What do you guys think?
I have a question, and I don't know if this is going to confuse the issue or not, but, I mean, first of all, I agree and understand what the year is that we're facing, and I hope that nobody here thinks that's something that we took lightly during our process. We, as we always do, start from zero, building our expense budgets, and you know, took a very thorough look. That said, absolutely, we can go back and look again. As you already requested, we can look at our pay-as-you-go in particular, but I think my question to help us do that is, it would be really helpful, and I don't expect the answer right now, but it would be really helpful to understand what are we looking at in FY19, because I have been around long enough, as have some of us at this table, that when we kick the can down the road, we create a situation for ourselves that's also difficult to deal with, and I think that's a factor in what we're dealing with tonight. So as we are evaluating what can we postpone. I can say right now, without speaking to anyone else, that there's nothing in here that we didn't think was important. So there's nothing that we can just go, ah. So doesn't mean we're not going to take a serious look, but it would be very helpful. And again, don't expect the answer right now, but if we could have it, we have our meeting on Thursday. understanding what do the next couple of years look like in terms of the tax, I think it may be in what we got handed tonight, but that would help me at least in making those decisions in terms of what to move forward or what to
actually. I think I have the answer to that. Mike mentioned that before, is that this year we're taking a much bigger hit, aren't we? And then next year, which drops down to about $1 million from whatever it is. So in next year, we're going from 2.1 to 1.9 of expected new growth, but this other nut only hits us at $1 million.
Yeah.
So we might be just kicking it down for 1 year, and we have an extra, $1.5 million, $2 million.
Right. But what I don't understand is how excess levy factors into that, because it's my very rudimentary understanding that money that we're talking about right now is really going to be excess levy next year, and I could be completely wrong about that. John will absolutely help me with that. He helps me with my math homework. But so, again, not an answer necessarily for right now, but that would just be really helpful to me personally in considering what we should prioritize.
Chris, would it be possible to get some projections out for the next 5 fiscal years as part of the analysis that everybody has to go through as we?
You have it
right here.
Yeah. So is that chart there?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So, Gene, have you seen that?
And this chart's, again, so I just want to make sure we're all talking about the same thing. This chart's the tax impact growth. I know I brought up that we talked earlier. I mean, the excess levy, we're essentially, this budget doesn't take a dime of the allowable levy.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Correct.
The levy is the total amount you can raise.
No, but I'm saying our excess levy growth next year is exactly the dollar amount of the allowable levy, because this growth that we're seeing here is all driven by excluded debt. So what this came back to earlier, and we're not going to bring up that awful word because we know we're not even close to it, but this is we're talking about where we as a collective group feel like what the town can afford and what we bring to it. We're not even approaching any statutory limits or anything here.
Right, but
I think what
you're hearing from the Board of Selectmen is, even though we have the ability to go get some money, we don't want to go past.
No. Yeah, but so like that, so I was saying, I think I was just pointing to Mrs. Birchman's question that the excess, we're not eating into levy in any of these years. It's this excluded debt that is the massive driver here. So that doesn't actually impact our levy. It just impacts the tax rate because we have to start paying the debt service. So. Yeah, and it looks like, if I'm reading this correctly, it's next year gets bad again, and then it starts to...
Yeah, I think 19 is another tough year.
Yeah.
But not as bad as this year.
But not as bad.
Could I just say 2 points?
Sure.
Number one, to your point, yes, but as you get out on those years, this becomes extremely... If you're off by a degree, yes, you go out, it's off by 10 degrees. Mm-hmm. So this could be astronomically out of whack in 2 years.
Yeah.
Because of what happens in the meantime. So that's number one point. So to be discussing what we can expect in 2 years is a little bit of a crapshoot. And then the only other point I would say is not only did they go to town meeting and vote this, they went to the polls and voted for this. Yes, so you have the opportunity. People don't have to be embarrassed, stand up and say no, they could have went to the polls. They voted yes. They were explained this is going to be painful, and yet they voted yes. Now what I'm hearing is, go back, you're only going to get one cruiser, whatever, to minimize the pain that you told them was coming. So if they don't get it, that there really isn't any pain because we keep dropping what we really need and pushing the can down the roads, then they're likely to keep voting for these debt exclusions in the future, to wit, the Elmwood, et cetera.
Yep.
So that would be my only point. I understand it's a little bit hard to take those types of increases, and we've dropped it quite a bit, but you have people that have already acknowledged that they know the debt is going up.
Okay. Anybody else specific to the motion on the table and the $545,000, Mike?
I would just say you have to be careful if you're going to pull
expenses or costs out of the operational budget, as Gene Birchman said, if you kick it down the road, especially when we have 2.1 million of new growth this year, you're not going to get that in the next couple of years, so it's going to be even more difficult to add it. If you try to say, well, let's put it off for 2 years, when you put it in 2 years down the road, it's going to be even harder to take because we're not going to have that new growth to help absorb it. So you have to be careful that I agree we have to be watchful down the road, and but this year's cost is really, or increase, is because of the excluded debt. And after next year, you know, 75% of it is this year, 25% next year. Then after that, it is built in, and it's strictly going to be dependent on, are we going to choose $4 to $7 million in new turf fields, or are we going to hold off on the sidewalks? Maybe we can put a moratorium for a couple of years. There is a slide on the presentation that Norman gave that shows in 3 or 4 years that debt starts to go down. So you can be smart about it, not to keep building and building while we're taking on this new debt. So there are some smart things you can do down the road, but you do have to be careful about the operational budget. Down the road, you don't want to increase it that much because our new growth will not be as large, and it'll be a bigger impact on the taxpayers if you kick something that you eventually want to do. You do one cruiser this year, knowing you need three cruisers in 2 years. That's when we're not going to have that new growth to help, or maybe even the free cash in 2 years to pay for that. So you have to get the big picture of what's coming.
Part of where we can kind of regulate some of that, to a degree anyway, is on these borrowing projects and what we even propose to town meeting.
Absolutely, and to what Chris Sandini said, that hey, if we did all these three projects and all our increase is only 3%, let's do some more. You know, there's a cost. You know, people did agree, and then they know what the. You know, hopefully most people know what the tax impact was going to be, but I think these were big projects, and we made sure we went through this process of not just having 150 people at town meeting vote for it, that we did want a debt exclusion, more so we could have maybe taken it within the levy capacity, but more so that you at least had another part of transparency where everyone got to vote at the polls if they couldn't make town meeting, and they still voted for all these things. So we went through a real vetting process on all these projects. Just to say we get through all of this with only 2.5% impact, my concern is that people are going to want more, and we're not going to have that new growth.
John.
Yeah, I think so. I would echo a little bit what Mr. Manning and Mr. Sandini said in terms of these projects, these debt exclusions that are driving this, were the will of the town, right? And the town was educated on what they cost and what their impact was going to be. And then as we're talking about making cuts to the parts of the budget that ultimately town meeting votes on these budgets, but I think we all recognize that in this process we all have more sort of granular control over what goes before town meeting. What we're going to end up doing is talking about cutting services that I would also argue that the citizens of the town expect. You know, when I look at the school budget and the process that we went through, and I know Mr. Herr and Mr. Kamalo and Mr. Manning were at those meetings. This was not a year where we introduced a significant new program. You know, this was not akin to the year where we introduced full-day kindergarten. We looked at this budget, and I should remember making a comment when we had the principals actually come to make their presentations, that the actual school building budgets, I think, keep me honest here, have almost no growth in the building budgets because of the investments that we've made. And the investments that we've made are resulting in a level of service in education, speaking for the school budget, that is what the people of Hopkinton expect. And I worry across the board, I know this is a tough year, but the people of the town voted for a tough year. They voted for these three projects. And I don't think, I mean, we obviously don't have time or the ability to poll them, but I would, based on the people I talk to, I would be surprised that most of them would be comfortable with us cutting back on services in order to pay for these projects that were approved by the town. And so I will say, will we go back as a school committee and take a look at it? Again, speaking as only one member, of course we will. This is something that we do generally speaking through this process. We'll work with the appropriation committee. But I am uncomfortable with the idea of the idea of cutting back on services that we're chartered to provide for the town, based on the driver in this budget. I think there are obviously instances, I know in past years ago when the economy was in a different place and we were looking at 0% budgets, that was driven by other issues. This is driven by decisions that the town made. And so I think that I honestly feel like we're almost subverting the will of the town if we're going to go back and cut services to pay for projects that they approve.
But I see it as, if I may, through the chair, sorry. We're talking about 0% budgets, but now we're talking 4% budgets. Mm-hmm. So we have to, what I'm trying to say is especially next year, if we're at 75%, next year we go to 25% on this debt service. You know, that gives us, another $1 million to play with. More of a cushion. And so some of these things that we're pushing down the road, we're only moving them a year. And it just might make it a little bit easier on people. Because I know people voted for it, but just like Mr. Hurd was saying about putting candy in front of somebody, at the time, this is killing me not to touch it because I'm doing this no-carb thing, and it's staring me in the face looking at the candy.
Let me help you with that.
If I may.
But it's one of these things we've just got to make sure that we're doing the best for everybody, because I don't know if people, because everybody has their favorite thing. I remember the previous chair, absolutely, wanted, was pushing the library, where there was a bunch of us pushing for schools. There's other people that want other things. And they got there, and everybody voted for it. But I don't know if people really understood what that impact, that Mike was up there saying, this is going to hurt everyone. And I don't know if everybody understood that what this pain was and what the pain's going to mean is for us right now to say, what are we going to cut?
Mrs. And Wright.
I just have 2 points. Yes, it won at the polls, but not everybody voted for it. A lot of people voted no. And I am sensitive to, we have a broad demographic in this town of different ages, different income abilities, people on fixed incomes. We do have a very large demographic of school-aged children and parents of school-aged children, and those drive a lot of these things. But the fact that this passed does not mean that every single taxpayer in this town felt this was something that they could support, and we have to be respectful of all our citizens and their ability to continue to live in this town. And to Mr. Manning's point about people saying, we got all this for only that much. They haven't seen the tax bill yet. I think this year, when you get an average $450 increase on your tax bill, all this stuff is theoretical. Oh, it's only going to be $1.59 per thousand on your tax bill, or it's this percent or whatever.
Cup of coffee a day.
It's not real money until the bill comes. Hasn't come yet. I think it's going to be a real shock.
Okay.
Also, I'll also just add that, maybe this is stereotyping, I don't know. But, there are people who have all their tax money put in escrow. They never see the tax bill. They really don't even know how much this is affecting their tax bill. And then there are the people who don't put money in escrow. They need that money in their bank account every month, and now they see the tax bill. And I would, again, not trying to stereotype anybody, but I would bet that it's more the people who are writing that check personally who are having a more difficult time writing the check for these. And so, again, back to the, Ms. Wright's point of not everybody voted for this, and we need to be sensitive to everybody.
Okay, I think we're kind of well down the path here and starting to repeat ourselves. Lori.
I just want to comment on the fact that, in some ways this feels a bit like deja vu from the last time that we all were here together to talk about this, because we were asked to have a commitment to look at our budgets very seriously. And the only, in some ways I feel a bit slighted, actually, in the fact that we spent months looking at our budget very diligently. And so it's my fiduciary duty in this role to go back and look, and you've asked us to do that, and we will go back and look. But the fact is, we also scrutinized for months in November and December. So I just want that on record, that this wasn't thrown together. It wasn't done without looking at all constituents and all levels of economics within the district, because in reality, all levels of the district are represented in the school children as well, and a lot of those unfunded mandates are, you know, they are benefiting both those at the lowest economic status as well as the highest. So I just needed to put it out there that we very carefully scrutinized the budget like we were asked to back in October and did it through November and December. We worked with the town to get to a timeline that would help be able to give more cushion to the timelines before a town meeting. And we are willing to do that again, but I feel like we've already done that work. So, you know, that's where my feeling is on this.
Okay. Anybody else? Mr. Kamalo, you've been very patient this evening.
I think the discussion has covered all the topics that the public needs to be aware of. I think one piece that we need to say loud and clear is that we're doing something unusual to balance the FY18 budget. We're using approximately $870,000 of free cash to pay for some components of the operating budget. So if you're looking down the road at the tax impact, that number has to be accounted for. Mm-hmm. I think my general message is that I think I have confidence that if we continue working together, we will find the solution. In my conversations with the Appropriations Committee going forward, I will specifically be interested in answering the following questions. Number one, by continuing to approve budget increases at the levels that we're discussing now, would this be sustainable 2-3 years down the road? Number two, we have to really take a very close and serious look at our formula for approving borrowings. I think on the one hand, the idea of debt excluding projects is a good idea. But if you're concerned about the excess levy, I think we absolutely need to answer this question to the members of the public, how we want to move forward. And then thirdly, I do understand the feeling that the public voted for these projects. I get that. I respect that. I also respect the fact that there's a process that we've put in place that is very rigorous. What I want members who are assembled here to be mindful of is, number one, the fact that the public has voted for these projects previously does not take away our future responsibility to continue to be vigilant financially. Number two, part of the formula in being rigorous in our budget process is the fact that we have multiple layers for vetting the budget. So for me, it doesn't come as a surprise that we're having this conversation. It's happening because by definition, we have these different layers that the budget goes through. And I say that respectful, mindful of the effort that goes on at the base level. And that's why in my remarks, I constantly remind people that the budgets that the town manager moves forward reflect what the boards and committees believe are the levels that the services need to be funded at. So in my conversations with the Appropriations Committee going forward, I think I'll specifically be interested in answering the question whether continuing to fund the budgets at the levels that we're proposing is sustainable long term, whether we're establishing a base that we may not be able to sustain given the fact that new growth is changing. We've been very lucky with free cash. I don't think we're going to continue getting free cash at 2.6 million. Most importantly, local revenues. Chris and I, we can't explain how our motor vehicle excise came as high as it did. We don't think that is going to repeat itself in the coming years. So there are issues that we need to discuss with the with the Appropriations Committee just to make sure that our approach is sustainable in the medium and long term.
Okay. So we have many volunteers at the table tonight, many dedicated staff with us here tonight going through this issue. And we've run over an hour, and I apologize for that. But the reason we ran over for an hour is because we all care very deeply about the town of Hopkinton. We care about getting Brendan's kids the best education possible, our kids the best education possible. We care about those that have to pay the taxes, those that graduated their kids 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago. We feel very passionate about the community, and you heard that here tonight. You know, when he and I go at it, it's because we love Hopkinton, and we love what we're doing, and we're trying to make the best thing we can, make the best decision possible. So this isn't an us versus them. This isn't you're right, you're wrong. This isn't any of that. This is us in a tough spot with incredible amount of debt service to build these great assets that we're all going to enjoy. And we're just working through it. So, you know, I think we need to sort of move ahead now. I think we need to table sort of the frustration because we've all felt it. But we've done it with the, you know, I think in the right vein and with the right view of how we're trying to move Hopkinton forward. So with that, I congratulate everybody for getting through this. I know it hasn't been easy, but I do think, you know, we're better for it as a community if we work together. This is one town. We got one set of assets we're building right now that's causing a big tax bill for all of us. And, you know, we're all in it together, and we got to work it together, too. If we keep working it together, we'll be fine. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve, or the chair will entertain, or take a vote to support the motion to send the budget to the Appropriations Committee with the target of removing $545,000 from the operating and pay-as-you-go capital budgets so that the net impact or tax impact net of new growth is no higher than 3%. Is that correct? Is that what the motion was in the second? Mm-hmm. Mr. Kamal, you good with that motion?
Yes.
Appropriations, you guys good with that motion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, and that's what we will do on the budget itself. Next item, folks, is the MSBA Statement of Interest discussion for the School Committee, the Board of Selectmen, specific to Elmwood School. I need to excuse myself for a couple minutes, Mr. Catino. I would just ask the schools if they could just present what their thoughts are.
Sure. Didn't we already do this?
Go ahead.
Yeah, let's go. Yes, let's go ahead with the presentation. Yeah.
So, in response to, as I mentioned earlier, the special town meeting, and specifically the NESDEC enrollment that took all of us by surprise, in the sense of we had been told for years and years that we've got this flat enrollment. There was a significant change to the information that we were being provided with. And that was after a lot of study. I mean, this was not something that we were just kind of blindly waiting for. You know that there have been many discussions over the years about enrollments, and we talked about Legacy Farms tonight. We've been watching it very, very carefully. So when what we had anticipated might be the case was confirmed, with the NESDEC enrollments, the school committee and the ESBC worked around the clock to work to see if we could add an addition to the project that's in place. We went to the MSBA, that was approved by them. You know, yes, you have our blessing to change the footprint of the project, but no, we're not going to give you any money for it. But in that discussion with them, they basically said that there's something very unique going on in Hopkinton, and that we're not seeing this in other districts. We talked about, you know, our location, yes, the performance of the schools, but also just the ideal location off 495 and the wonderful assets that the town has resulted in this being a very a community that people want to move to. And I think the final thing that I didn't mention was just the range of housing options that are now in place that maybe were not in place 5 years ago. So those are all good problems, right? We're happy about all of these things, but one of the things that they said when we were there, and one of the things that we've been hearing as a school committee ever since, is what are you doing about enrollment across the town? Yes, you've asked for an addition for the K-1 building, but what about this 380 students? And honestly, I think that is a projection, is under-projected, if they're saying that now, over all of our buildings over the next 10 years. So I've worked with the school committee over many of their meetings to present them with some data, the data that I have based on NESDEC, the numbers of students that are coming in and are projected to come in. I've also worked with the principals to look at capacity. So we've been looking at enrollment and we've been looking at capacity. And one of the things that became very obvious was that we have some options, more options at the middle and high school around scheduling that can allow us to deal with increased enrollments over the long term. So we feel like we have some great solutions there. But at the lower elementary level, specifically the Elmwood School and the Hopkins School, we are already at capacity. And we are housing class sizes of 24 and 25 in some cases. We do have some opportunity at the Elmwood School when the preschool relocates to the new building. That will open up 4 classrooms. So we're looking at everything. But one of the things that I've learned in being here is how long this work takes. So we were just entering into feasibility when I got here 4 years ago. And we're still a year and a half out before that building is going to open. So this conversation takes time. And yet I'm faced with making recommendations to the school committee and to be preparing the town for these increased enrollments. So one of the things that I proposed to the school committee at their most recent meeting was to get to seek their approval on submitting a statement of interest to even get in the pipeline, because sometimes it takes several times. Now we have submitted SOIs twice before, but it was never the priority SOI. One of the first things that MSBA asks you is this your priority project? And Elmwood never was. It was always the replacement of the center school. There was one when they went in together because there was some potential that it might be a joint solution because we didn't yet know where the location of the building was going to be. But we're faced now with knowing right now today that I've got concerns, we all do, about the capacity within those 2 lower elementary buildings. We are already using specialist classrooms, for example, the health room, the science room, for classroom spaces. So we've looked at everything, not just traditional classrooms, but also using alternative classroom spaces. However, we like to look at those alternative classroom spaces as short-term solutions, not a long-term solution. So that brings me here tonight. As you can see on your agenda, the school committee did vote on February the 16th for the submission of the SOI. And one of the requirements of the process is that I seek the approval of the Board of Selectmen as well. There's some very specific language in the motion in your packet. And so I'm here tonight. We are here tonight to answer any questions that you have and to see whether or not this is something that you would be interested in.
Thank you. Any questions?
I have one question. It appeared there were 2 components to it. One, I understand it is dealing with the overcrowding, which you're speaking of, and how you address that, whether it's an addition or temporary classrooms or steel buildings or whatever, that would all fall under that. But then there is this replacement renovation of various systems.
Yes.
And at least the way this is worded, it doesn't look like it's because these systems are failing as much as we'd be looking to do upgrades to improve energy conservation and decrease energy-related costs. That's usually something that the payback takes place over time. And so I guess I would question, or like a little more information,
sure,
about how important that is, because based on our previous discussion, I think we're all looking at what's a want and what's a need.
So thank you for that question. This is my first time submitting an SOI, and it's been quite an education for me, just even to be able to manipulate the forms. But it's very limited. So they give you the language around your options, and there are 7. So you can say emergency replacement, and that puts you in a whole different category. That means the roof is falling down, right, the boiler's not working. Then they give you the language that you are reading in the motion tonight, one being the enrollment that I've discussed at length. The other is the condition of the building itself. And so this, when I talk about a 5 years out, we have some serious concerns about the heating system, for example, in the building. These are things that have been submitted, I think, as long as 5 years ago. I'm looking at Jean because
at least, yeah,
she was here when that one was submitted. And so as I've been working through this process of preparing the SOI and learning more about it, I'm seeing significant concerns, and of course I've been aware of these concerns just dealing with them with maintenance over time. So boilers, bathrooms, not the field so much because that's an outdoor issue. The roof was replaced 3 years ago, I think it was the first year, my first year here. Mm-hmm. So there's been work done on the building over time, but it feels like now that I've been reading more about it, that there are ongoing issues that have not been addressed because there were other priorities. Specifically, the center school was just in worse shape. Mm-hmm. So that's why the SOI, or the statement of the problem, which is what they want me to be able to submit, is twofold. It's not just enrollment, it's also the condition of the building.
Right. No, I guess my question was focused on, I see two different kinds of capital replacement needs. One, the things on its last legs, it's dying.
Yeah.
Versus, we could get better energy efficiency if we got something newer, fancier. That's a want, or a, you know, one is a need and the other is a want. So I wasn't clear from this what we're really looking for.
Can I add a little bit of history too? Yeah. So some of the items that are, you know, that would be considered in the feasibility and as part of the SOI, were identified as long ago as like 2000 or 2001 with the Elmwood School Parity Report that was generated as part of the first attempt to go through the building process before the MSBA had a moratorium on building process. And I don't want to take us all the way down that road again, but this isn't anything new. A lot of these facilities needs have been on our radar screen for a very long time. You mentioned that you went to that school, and I don't want to guess how old you are, but I'm going to assume it wasn't new then. So we need to, you know, we need to continue to invest, obviously, in the maintenance and structure of our buildings. And so, as Kathy said, a lot of that language is given to us and prescribed. It doesn't mean that we would like the temperature internally to be 68 instead of 70. It's not what we're talking about, and all of that is what the feasibility process is, the information that comes out as part of the feasibility process. So this is just to get into the pipeline to be invited in by the MSBA to have the project considered. So I can see why it looks that way based on their language, but we're not trying to do something swanky. We're trying to, you know, maintain our building and extend its life. Okay.
Yeah, and I think I would just add to that is that, you know, SOI stands for Statement of Interest. So we are stating our intentions as a district to the MSBA that we have a building that's in need. And they, while they prescribe from their legalese what those reasons may be, this is not saying that we're planning on rebuilding an entire new building or that we're only going to do one wing. We don't actually know any of that yet. We have to have a subcommittee evaluate all of that, do the feasibility study, but this, we can't even get to that place where we can find out what we need until we are invited into this process. So this is the first step.
That was my question, is the goal here, like, when K1 is done and we house it and it's running at 100% in a couple of years, the excess students, I don't believe Elmwood's going to be able to house the amount of excess, you know, the amount of students that's coming through. So is the goal to repair, remodel Elmwood School, or is the goal to build another school? And that's all part of, they'll tell us what our goal is.
We have a simultaneous, the school committee has tasked me with a simultaneous two tasks, one being to consider submitting the SOI, and the other is to form a committee, a subcommittee of the school committee, to look at that very question.
So,
because we feel like we need to do those two things at the same time.
And I just want to say, when your last comment, they'll tell us what, they will not. So these SOI allows us, if they accept us into their process, allows us to look at the feasibility of a new building. We would form a, it's probably a similar elementary school building committee, as a town that would go out and select a number of options to do feasibility on, very exactly the same way that we did with the center school solution. And again, ultimately, it was you know, our town decision to do new construction versus renovation of that project. The MSBA is not going to prescribe that. The only thing they do prescribe is one of the options that you explore in feasibility does have to be a renovation. Mm-hmm. So we could look at, you know, a renovation to Elmwood. We could look at five other options if they're available to us, and then we would, as a town, go forward much like we, not much like, exactly like we did with this, the center school process. As Lori said, this is literally just saying, hey, we're interested, would you invite us into this, what we know is a long and arduous process to start looking at a solution that we don't even know what it is yet.
Works for me. Thank you.
Sure. Are reimbursement rates higher for renovations versus new building?
Exactly. They're exactly the same.
They're exactly the same. What's our reimbursement rate on the new school right now?
47?
40.
Is it that high?
Is it? Yeah, is it around 44, 45?
Oh, yeah, I mean, 44, 45, yeah, when it comes into all the adjustments, yeah.
Yeah.
But those, I mean, with the caveat that those reimbursement rates haven't exactly been going up, so I wouldn't necessarily expect that our next project we would be that high. Mm-hmm.
But the benefit is that when the new school is built, we will have four classrooms to absorb for a little while.
Correct. Yes. So that's a good thing.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Sestari.
My preference would be to, complete this conversation, I guess, you know, for whatever information people want to try to draw. But I'd also prefer to defer any vote to a meeting at the end of March when we have more information regarding the articles that are coming in on for the town meeting warrant, and also where our budget stands, so that we can make more informed decisions.
Okay, does that suggestion cause any concern or delays in the process with timing of the MSBA?
Yes.
What would those be, please?
So the drop-dead deadline is the end of April. The vote that the school committee made was that it would be submitted by the end of March. The other piece, you know, to make sure people understand is that we might not even be invited in, and even if we are, the process itself would take steps such that we wouldn't even be looking at the need for the money. Right away. I don't know if you have a better sense of what the timeline would be, John, but
I was seeing $300,000 on the budget for this year.
Well, it is as a placeholder, yeah, again, because A, we don't know if we're going to be invited in, but we won't know that unless we submit. We don't know what the competition is, but I am feeling anxious, and I don't use that word lightly, that we do have a plan in place. So I understand that this item on the agenda was probably not in the best place after the conversation that we just had. But I think it's something that I would be remiss if I was not recommending strongly that we move forward with at least exploring what the possibilities are.
From a timeline perspective, if we think about the MSBA, so one of the reasons why we put the feasibility study article on this May's town warrant, knowing that we may not even be invited. So we'll submit the SOI. So let's say this is approved and we submit the SOI at the end of March. They have several board meetings over the next year in which they consider proposals at their discretion.
Yeah.
So we could be invited in June, we could be invited in September, we could be invited in next January, or if you don't get on any of those boards and you get to next April, it's their way of telling you you didn't get in and you need to think about applying again. So if you are invited in, as much as it seems like with the new elementary school project, it's taken a really long time, there are aspects of their process that actually don't take a lot of time at all. And certain things, if we get invited in, we begin the feasibility stage, and we have a certain amount of time to receive local approval for that feasibility study. One of the things we did right in the last project was we actually got the feasibility study approval before we got invited in, so that we didn't have to call a special town meeting because we need feasibility study approval within, and I don't know the exact date, but it's like 90 days of getting invited into feasibility. And so what this does is it puts us in the advantageous position for whenever we're invited in. We don't start the process, we don't borrow or spend a dime until we're invited in, until we've established a school building committee, until that school building committee has had the opportunity to engage with the MSBA and begin that process. All this does is puts us in the, that capital article puts us in a position where whenever we are invited in, we're actually ready to start without having to scramble. And so that's a little bit more about sort of the timeline and the process. Again, we may be back here in February of 2018 saying we didn't get invited in, so we want to. It's actually pretty typical that when you submit, you don't get in the first time, you get in the second time. So we could very well be back here in February of 2018, but at that time, we'd still be in the advantageous position to begin the process whenever we are invited in.
But we're also looking for funding, whereas we weren't last time.
Well, right, we're looking for funding from
the
them.
MSBA.
Right. Yes.
And
yes.
Last time we were not.
Right.
And that was very clear through the previous yep. project. That, right? So we would be looking for MSBA funding, you know, to, mm-hmm. to help with the feasibility part of the project.
So I don't see the harm in us putting this off to the end of March. I understand that there is the school committee imposed deadline of the end of March to submit this, and I respect that, but the MSBA's deadline is the end of April. And we can get more information, and we can look everything over and make a vote at that point. I think that that's the more prudent way to approach this.
Anybody else?
I'm good. I'm done arguing. All done.
Give it a minute. Okay, so I think we have one suggestion to hold off until the end of April. Mrs. Wright, any thoughts?
No, till the end of March.
Till the end of March, sorry.
I'm just not clear what additional information will be gleaned between now and then that would make a difference in terms of, I understand the case the school committee is making that you need to have your ducks in a row. And it looks like demographically, we can see where this is going with the need at Elmwood. So
we're going to have a better idea of where the budget is. We're going to have an idea of all the articles that are coming through on the town meeting warrant that people are going to vote on. Those are the two big things.
So I don't know if this makes a difference, but based on the process and the timing, I don't think there's any chance that this is actually getting, that any of this money is going to get spent in the FY18 budget.
And if we do the statement of interest now, and then a town meeting, there's an article and it doesn't pass, well, then that kind of ends it there too.
Yeah.
So
I'm not sure I know what you mean.
If we say go ahead, let's do the statement of interest or pass whatever that motion is that they need for us to pass, and they write the letter and they reach out, and then it may, for that $300,000, which is actually $600,000, but $300,000 will be covered by the MSBA, town meeting says no, well then it's over anyway. But let's not, why do we hold her up from writing a letter or getting their ducks in a row between now and then?
I don't think it's holding anybody up from writing the letter. So we're just voting on one thing. We're not giving anybody authority to write a letter or anything like that.
Oh, it's not a letter.
Yeah.
It's a whole application process.
It's a very involved application process.
But are you saying that you wouldn't spend the money until you get invited in?
Or? Right.
We would not borrow or spend a dime until
so
we
that
get
money sits on the
not
shelf.
Not allowed to.
No.
No.
The appropriation sits on the shelf. We wouldn't borrow, so it would be borrowing. So it's essentially, it's an appropriation placeholder. There's no money until we get invited in.
Right.
So if, let's say the MSBA, I mean, this won't happen, but let's just say the MSBA never invited us in. There would be no money. It's right. Just an appropriation. There's no borrowing. There's no money.
And so because you said very often, you don't get it the first time you get invited in, maybe the second time.
Yep.
So that money would just be held.
Yep.
And so it might not even be spent until the following year, but nothing's going to be spent until the process starts to move along.
Right.
It just
Correct.
Sets us up, because if we didn't appropriate it this year, you couldn't make the application, and then we'd be a year behind in the whole. Yes. We wouldn't.
Or we would have to have a special town meeting.
Right, right.
If I may, my only fear is be careful what you wish for, because what if it hits? What if we get in this year, and then all of a sudden we're just in the middle of we're saying we want to tighten our budgets, the belts and budgets and everything, that we have to go to a town meeting or a special town meeting and say, hey, we're going to be building another new school. We luckily got a spot. That's what scares me.
It took over 2 years.
Yeah, I know, but I would just.
It's not a reality.
So from my perspective, these guys have spent years doing these statement of interest and all this other stuff for all these other schools, starting with the first elementary school 10 years ago. I have no clue what you have to go through. And sitting here for 10 minutes, I'm never going to understand what you have to go through. So why would we not to defer to our colleagues who are elected to take care of the schools to either figure out if they need to send an SOI or not? I mean, if we're not spending money tonight, I don't see why we would slow that down.
Can I just ask, in the unlikely scenario that Mr. Contino just laid out, when slam bang, all of a sudden they approved it, and just supposed, is there a time frame in which you have to use that money? You say, we can't afford to do it right now. We need to put it off for a couple of years. I mean, could we wait on that?
So
we got an approval?
The initial appropriation is for feasibility.
No. But if the whole thing went through and they gave us
for the
approval,
feasibility.
Yeah.
There's some flex. I mean, there are some set timelines that they have with the process. Obviously, they're a government agency that appropriates funding, and mm-hmm. so they're trying to book their, you know, they're trying to book the money that they had, the grant money that they have for the year. So they want to know that we are going to come back to them for reimbursement within an established time frame. That being said, the other advantage that I would say that we have right now in terms of if they were to turn around, you know, we apply in April and at their June board meeting, surprise, we got in. We are, because of the project and especially because of the professionals we're working with at Compass, our project managers for the other building, we're almost constantly in contact with the MSBA. So this isn't going to happen somewhere in an office in Boston and they're going to all of a sudden pick up the phone one day. We've already had some discussions with them sort of at our meeting where we talked about the new elementary school expansion. They are very much a partnership organization. So I do think that there would be opportunity. I mean, when we did get approved for the new elementary school, we knew ahead of time, hey, we're thinking about considering you on this board meeting. So I think there is definitely going to be the opportunity to work with them. I don't think this would be something where they would come back to us and say, you're in, you've got to build this building by X date.
Right.
And the other thing I would just add is, because this came up during our meeting, because I actually was one of the ones opposed to doing this at this time. And the reasoning, because we're still building a building and we have all these other things going on in town. And John actually made the point to me was that the reality was Center School was supposed to be the project 5 years ago and Elmwood was supposed to be the project now. We've kicked the can down with Elmwood because of the way how long it took to get to the Center School solution. So the fact is that Elmwood's been deteriorating at the same rate, and now we have the enrollment issue, which is added on top of it. Initially, the issue was that Elmwood was in need of repair, mm-hmm. and now we have enrollment on top of that. So from my standpoint, it's the statement of interest is really, we're just kicking off a process that's going to take years. So at this point in time, I mean, even when we discussed with our project manager, does it make sense to even put in a statement of interest if you really don't think that it's something the town's willing to do at this point? And he was like, absolutely, because it needs to demonstrate to the MSBA that the school's committed to this facilities and upkeep and things of that nature. So from our standpoint and our responsibility to upkeeping our facilities, that was the reason why making the decision now to start with a statement of interest was the decision that the committee made. And what also persuaded me that the timing was okay now. But I understand it's hard to take this in when you have a building that we're just breaking ground on over there. I understand that.
And I apologize for that you know, the facetious statement that, you know, the, if it all hit it, we hit it once. But if we have the four classrooms, is there any, I know it's any, as you were saying, 30,000 foot, you know, estimate of how many years those four classrooms will buy us so that we can work backwards? The four, when we move the
Oh, you mean the preschool classrooms?
The preschool classrooms,
right, so
when they
Mr.
move
Coutinho,
out.
Mr. Coutinho, it's a bigger problem that also involves the other school, and that's why I said the simultaneous committee. We're actually in worse shape at Hopkins. We have less room at Hopkins than we have at Elmwood with the four classes opening up in 2018. So we need to look at what's going on in both of those buildings. But if I may, I stand corrected. Lori had thought that the deadline was sooner, and I did go into my, yeah. The deadline for the close for the core program is actually April 7th. Yeah. I apologize for that misinformation. And I think that when I was beginning to look at the actual submission, I was required, you can't leave any spaces, so I chose the end of March. And in my mind, I knew it was an April submission, but I checked at Lori's request, and it is indeed April 7th, if that changes anything.
So one other thing that just crossed my mind is you're looking for $300,000 for this, but overall you're looking for $600,000.
It's the other way around. The what's going to be on the warrant article is going to be $600,000. The MSBA will pay for close to $300,000 of those costs if we're invited in.
Definitely.
Yeah, so on the most recent building, the reason they did not fund part of the feasibility study is because they had already funded a feasibility study for this project, which resulted in the failed Fruit Street School vote.
Yep.
So they won't fund a second feasibility study for the same project, basically.
Yep.
But their standard process for a new project is that the feasibility study is part of reimbursable expenses and would be reimbursed at the whatever the calculated rate is, which is, Mr. Kamalo, between us, we think it's around 44 or 45.
Okay. So there's no way that if this thing does get approved, that they could approve it with no money.
No, they would not do that. That's not their process.
But we have to put up the 600K this year, and we won't be looking to get the money back until whenever they invite us.
So the way they
we
work
don't have
now
to put it up unless we get invited in.
And the way they work, so it used to, and that's why we still have a line item on here somewhere about MSBA reimbursement. The way it used to work is we would have to actually put up the $600,000, and then we would pay the entire feasibility costs, and then they would reimburse us. Mm-hmm. They don't work that way anymore. Mm-hmm. They work on a pay-as-you-go reimbursement. Mm-hmm. So we will submit, the way we're doing with the construction right now, we will submit to them as we pay, and they'll reimburse us. So we'll only end up borrowing $300,000-ish of that appropriation, because they'll pay on the real-time reimbursement.
And if it gets delayed for a year, then that $300,000 would be in the next fiscal year.
So you don't take
and
it
debt
out
service wouldn't kick in until we start going to actually borrow the money.
Right.
You appropriate, that's nice, until you go get the cash, then you're starting to pay your bills.
Right.
And
okay,
that was my point of earlier, which is based on the timing of their board meetings, even if we got accepted in this cycle, this idea that we'd be spending much or any of this money in FY18 is tough to believe anyway.
You know, when I stepped away for a couple minutes just to take a little walk, I was thinking about how much time we spend in the community as leaders in the community, as volunteers in the community, sorting out and dealing with the growth of Hockington. 90% of tonight has been about the growth and the work it creates for us. Imagine being a selectman or a school committee member in a town of 15,000 people. It's been 15,000 for 50 years, and it's going to be 15,000 for another 50 years. I mean, you're just going to manage what you have. You're going to maintain great facilities, but you don't have all the stress and strain of this growth. This growth is a huge, it's a great opportunity, but it creates an awful lot of work and an awful lot of tension. And we're feeling it tonight. And so this is another example of that. This is just growth 101 all over again. We just got to start having like growth cigars or something. I don't know. It's crazy.
If the MSBA rejects the request, is it still the intent to move on with a feasibility study?
No.
No.
We would wait and try again a year later.
Because the motion is going to say 50% is coming from the MSBA.
Right.
Well, we've already filed this twice and not been invited in, so we haven't done that. I mean, same thing with the center school. So we just, it expires after the year, and then you refile and get back in line. As Lori said, I initially was not in favor of going forward with this year, but you know, I think the strong recommendation of our current project manager and you know, who has much more direct and frequent experience with the MSBA was really that start the process now because it's going to take a long time.
In those prior filings, though, I think John mentioned that it was a secondary project and they're and they're reluctant to fund two projects at the same time in one town. So.
And they wouldn't, again, so it's not like they'd reject a project on the merits. It's a question of they've only got so much money to spend, and we might, there might be eight towns that are higher priority than us. Mm-hmm. So it would be a reapplication next year, and they sort of create their own priority list and when they're going to invite us in.
But specific to the comment a second ago, the motion at town meeting would be that MSBA funding would be approximately 45% or something along those lines. In that motion,
the motion talks about the MSBA reimbursement. I don't remember whether the numbers in there.
Yeah,
I,
the motion, yeah. Have the motion.
Yeah. Well, no, there's a different motion tonight than
for town meeting.
I don't know if you know the answer to this question, but at what point do they consider the center school project to no longer be, something that they're funding? I know that they make their payments as you go and as you're making payments, but at what point is that no longer a cloud hanging over, you know, this other filing?
I think it depends. It's
Over the other filing?
They'll reimburse on the same track that we're paying it, right?
So I think what he's asking.
That's what they're doing now.
Filings, the other was the primary and you had the secondary. They don't like to fund two things at the same time.
So we're out of, they are very distinct in their phasing of projects. So we are well out, obviously, of the feasibility phase for the center school project. And when you move from one phase to another, it's really, you get an entirely new team. So new project manager, new everything, not our owner's project manager, but at the MSBA. So from the feasibility process perspective, that project that's being built over there is already out. So it would not impact the priority of, they wouldn't say we've already got a project going because we're already out of feasibility.
That's what I was wondering.
Yep.
They've asked, is this the priority project, you know, as part of the submission? And there's two boxes, yes and no. So that's what they care about.
Right.
Yeah.
And you say after this, we can pretty much expect something for Hopkins down the road.
No.
Oh, I thought that's what...
No, I
thought,
I didn't.
I'm sorry.
I know, I'm sure that that's what you heard because I was saying that they're also at capacity. What I said was that the school committee is also wanting to look at forming a subcommittee to look at enrollment and capacity across... The two schools.
I apologize for saying. I thought that's what I heard. So.
No. Oh, of course. No. Hopkins is in very good shape in terms of the actual building, and so we don't need to be looking at repairs or anything, you know, huge there. But what we do want to look at is opportunities that might be in front of us for looking at enrollment across the district, and so that's why we feel like taking this upcoming year to do that. Before we get potentially into what might be design, would be just, you know, smart to do.
Okay, I'd like to try and draw this to a close if possible. Everybody okay, at least with where we are? Mr. Kamala, is there a motion that's specific to this request?
Yes, it was included in the meeting.
Could you read it for me, please?
Yeah, it's a long motion.
Right here.
Yeah.
Yes.
I apologize because I had to read it too.
Yeah. Having convened in an open meeting on February 28, 2017, prior to the closing date, the Board of Selectmen of Hopkinton, Massachusetts, in accordance with its charter, bylaws, and ordinances, has voted to authorize the superintendent to submit to the MSBA the statement of interest form dated March 31st, 2017, for the Elmwood School, located at 14 Elm Street, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, which describes and explains the following deficiencies in the priority category for which an application may be submitted to the MSBA in the future. 4.1, priority number 4, prevention of severe overcrowding expected to result from increased enrollments. And 2, priority number 5, replacement, renovation, or modernization of school facility systems, such as roofs, windows, boilers, heating, and ventilation systems, to increase energy conservation and decrease energy-related costs in a school facility, and hereby further specifically acknowledges that by submitting this SOI form, the Massachusetts School Building Authority in no way guarantees the acceptance or the approval of an application, the awarding of a grant, or any other funding commitment from the MSBA, or commits the city. I think this answers some of the questions that the board was asking. Or commits the city, town, regional school district to filing an application for funding with the MSBA.
Okay, so Mr. Kamala read a suggested motion. Anybody want to make that motion?
I'd just like some clarification on the one priority number four, two priority number five verbiage. I don't know what that means.
So it's specifically written out by the MSBA in the statement of interest application how that has to be written. So the like when it says one and then number four is of the set of seven reasons that we can choose from.
Okay.
So when you choose your reason, you have to add it in that way.
Okay. That's
so it's specified by them.
And the I mean apart from a desire to be green and comfortable, the number two stuff, that also helps get the reimbursement, right? If we're making things more energy efficient and all of that, they like to see that.
It really is the renovation portion of the reasoning. So, like, if you need a new windows, if you need a new heating system, it's really the only option to choose. It's just they have the green language in there. I mean, of course, as we're doing with the new center school, the green is a thing that we're all looking at, but it's not as if, like, if you're choosing something to make renovations and fix things that are broken in the school, that's your only option to choose.
I will forward the SOI to the Board of Selectmen, and you will see the detail of the types of things and the condition of the school and the reports. They're extremely detailed. Part of it had been done, as Jean said, in the past, and then updated by Al Rogers, but there's a lot of information on the current conditions and the reasons behind why we're submitting for both of those reasons.
I move the motion as stated by Mr. Kamala.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion on the table and a second to advance the motion read by Mr. Kamala. Any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
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 Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries.
Thank you.
I believe our joint meeting is coming to a close.
You don't want us to stay?
Thank you guys for your patience tonight and all your work. Okay, Mr. Kamala, I'm going to ask as we hit each agenda item, what needs to be addressed tonight and what can be postponed? Okay?
Okay. Next item, annual town meeting articles,
yep,
needs to be addressed tonight.
Okay.
Annual town election ballot questions need to be addressed tonight.
Okay, so let's just stop right there and we'll get on to that. Number six. Item number six, the Board of Selectmen will consider submitting articles in the 2017 annual town meeting warrant. A list of potential Board of Selectmen sponsored articles. Mr. Yeah. Kamal.
Yes. In the packet, we had circulated a list of potential articles. Because the warrant is still open, that list has expanded, so I'm forwarding to you an updated list.
Okay.
And I'll try and go through this list very quickly, Mr. Chair.
Hold on one sec, please.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Mr. Kamala, proceed, but I'm going to recuse myself from the discussions on item one and two. If we ever get into a dialogue, I'll leave, but otherwise I'll keep quiet. Go ahead.
Okay. items one and two, this is in response to the article that was passed at town meeting. We have two prospective pilot agreements that we are discussing with developers, one at 5 Macadam Road, with Amoresco Solar, and the second one is on East Main Street with Marathon Solar. Okay. Number three, we've raised this issue with the board before. This is in regard to the fact that the Hopkinton Scouting Association could not find an appropriate location for the Scout Lodge on the property, and they did suggest that the town looks into the possibility of giving them some or leasing them some property on Fort Street.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Number four, changing constable from elected to appointed. And this came through the charter review process. Number five, following up on the discussion that the entity that is interested in holding the Hopkinton Day, discussions with the selectmen, we are proposing that the selectmen consider either placing a funding request not to exceed $30,000 to support the Hopkinton Day celebration, or in the alternative, and which I think most likely this is what is going to happen, that if we're able to find some funding in the current budget to pay for the work that they are now looking into, not to exceed $30,000, as I said, we will therefore be asking the selectmen to simply place an article requesting a resolution at town meeting to support Hopkinton Day.
Okay.
Number six, this is specifically a very limited request which will allow alcohol sales at town facilities. The idea here being the town is currently building three buildings, the elementary school, the library, as well as DPW. Under the existing town bylaw, if the town was to have a grand opening ceremony or a gala for the opening of those activities, alcohol cannot be saved. So we're asking that the selectmen look at identifying a very strictly and narrowly defined exemption to celebrate the coming online of major facilities in town. And this would be a one-time event.
So you're not looking for the DPW to sell a case of beer because the blizzard's coming in?
No, okay. Exactly. Yeah, it's just the celebration of the facility coming online.
Okay.
Yes. We also have received a request for the adoption or for town meeting to consider a law defining when boards should prepare and approve minutes for public meetings. This would be consistent with the open meeting law. We have a request also from the town clerk regarding revising the posting of the warrant bylaw. Currently, the posting is limited to using a constable. We believe we have other more opportunities in town to do that. And in addition, we're also looking at other methods for posting the warrant. That will include using the website as well as the town public safety buildings that are open to the public 24/7. And number nine, nuisance bylaw. This is intended to address some of the issues regarding blighted properties that have come to the attention of the board over the last three or four years.
Blighted properties?
Where people store junk.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, on their properties.
Did that come out of Zach, or where did this, who wrote this?
There was the option to move this through a zoning bylaw, but I think the thinking is that it may be more appropriate moving this through the general town bylaw. That's why this is coming before the Board of Selectmen.
It became more of a general bylaw, which has to go through the Board of Selectmen as opposed to a zoning bylaw.
And then
we're going to come back to the ones we want to have questions on. Yeah. Number 10?
And then number 10, revising the kennel bylaw. I think given recent developments in town, there's a need to revise that bylaw. And also, number 11, this is following up on some preliminary discussions held in preparation for the last annual town meeting, where Bay Path Humane Society is looking for an opportunity to partner with the town in building in a facility to house animals. We have had, I believe, what is a productive, efficient, cost-effective relationship so far, and we're asking that the selectmen consider placing an article that will authorize lease negotiations on Fruit Street property with Bay Path Humane Society. Number 12, senior tax relief. This is a topic that the board has considered for a while. Recall we presented two options. Trying to remember when this was, but sometime last year, the selectmen acted on one of the questions, which did not require town meeting approval. And then the other issue, the board felt that it needed more discussion. And if the board does agree, following those discussions, you will place an article on town meeting seeking senior tax relief. And I believe there may actually be another citizen petition that may be coming forth regarding the same topic. And then number 13, we're also trying to take advantage of the Municipal Modernization Act provisions. There are several opportunities that we are looking into that we would like the selectmen to move forward to town meeting. This may include with the last piece, how the town regulates speed limits.
May I add one? Or do we want to discuss these before we talk about additions?
Yeah. Let's try these first, if that's okay. So, Mr. Sestari, Mr. Catino,
does anybody have any questions on the pilot agreements 1 and 2?
We haven't seen any detail, but I'm assuming that as we draw closer, we'll see detail and, right?
Yes.
On any one of these, I mean, right now we're basically supporting a placeholder for these. And then as we start to see more details, we can withdraw our support for the article itself, right? Which would basically make it go down without a vote.
Correct, because the warrant closes March 1st.
Okay, number 3, scouting.
Yeah, I mean, I think
all right, so I'll go from here. So number 3, anybody have a problem with this moving forward to be an article?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's something that we need a lot more detail on, but in theory, no, I don't have any problem.
Okay, number 4, change constable from elected to appointed.
I don't remember discussing this, but I'm fine with it.
Is there any need for that to be in the charter or anything like that?
I'll let the town clerk.
30,000 feet, Connor. We're not making big decisions tonight. Just.
So just to answer the question straight up is that there's no direct requirements because if I'm correct, it was left out of the charter. For the reviewed version. Todd, you probably know more about what was talked about with the elected constables in the charter than I would at this point, but the actual decision itself doesn't even need to go to a charter decision. It can just be by vote of the town.
Thanks.
Okay, so we're okay with that one going ahead. So my gut or my sense is, I guess we'll take a motion to approve all of these or something, right, at some point here tonight. But so far, so good. Number 5, everybody okay with continuing to support this either financially or with a resolution?
The 300th celebration was an amazing day, I think. You know, it was a weekend, week, year. I have no idea. You know, again, I guess we have to see this develop and how it develops. But, you know, I can't see presenting something on the warrant that's going to cost any significant amount of money for this right now. So, I mean, I guess I'll leave it at that. And I'm certainly not going to try to block it from being on there right now. But, I mean, if we're looking at something that's going to be, you know, whatever, $50,000 or, you know, something like that, it's not something I can support right now.
Okay, but we're going to leave it on for the warrant itself.
I'm just kind of making a statement, though, just what my expectation is as we go forward.
I agree with Mr. Sestari.
Number six, alcohol sales at town facilities with prior approval from the Board of Selectmen. In particular, the library, I'm sure, is going to want to do a grand opening. Maybe the DPW will want to. I mean, I don't see this happening at an elementary school, per se, but I think anywhere else, maybe, where it's a grown-up event.
So my question on this is, if they're grand openings, it's a bit tacky to ask someone to buy a beer. If you're going to have a grand opening and have alcohol, you're going to give the beer out. You're not going to sell the beer. You may have somebody donate 10 cases of beer .
But in terms of just the general concept of...
And if so, I wouldn't mind being a vendor. I'd be glad to go out with my little hat and cart and sell beers to everybody, but... I've never been to a grand opening where they said, thanks for coming to our grand opening. This is our thing here. I need $4 for a beer.
The idea of having beer at the facility, is that okay?
Having beer, yes, but not
so that's
selling.
Really kind of what we have to decide tonight, I think.
Well, yeah. I'll be the contrarian. I'm not good with it.
Okay, so that's one no. Any other no's? I get it.
Should I just tell you why, or you just want a head count
now? I don't think we need to know why. Everybody else is okay?
I mean, it's on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, it is a case-by-case. You know, I agree with, I don't want...
You're still talking beer.
Beer, wine. Center school, like the school. I don't know. I don't have a strong opinion.
Okay, so in terms of moving the article to town meeting, we have four people, I think, okay with that and one that's not. We don't need to debate it because it's the four saying, let's go. I don't mean to be rude. I'm just trying to get us...
No.
Keep us going. We got a lot to do yet tonight. So that's okay. Adopt the minutes bylaw. Everybody okay?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I missed what that was. I had to step out.
Adopt a minutes bylaw so that we'd have more specific requirements for committees and boards in terms of how they keep minutes, where they keep minutes, when they submit minutes.
May I ask, will we have any opportunity to discuss what's in this before we go ahead with it? Because having read it, I felt that the 14, knowing these are volunteer committees, minutes are often kept by volunteers. I really felt the 14, the idea, the thought behind it was right, but the 14 days can be quite onerous on some volunteers, that stretching it to something like 30 would be more feasible for volunteer boards.
Is that something that's dictated by the state?
My understanding is that this may be coming from the open meeting law requirements. Clearly, the board will have the opportunity to discuss this going forward.
Okay.
Yeah, it's simply putting it on the warrant.
I've been on boards where that could be a problem.
Yeah. Revise the posting of warrant by law.
Again, I think...
It's technology, I assume.
Yes, technology and also the venues.
Sorry?
And also the venues that are open to the public 24/7.
Okay. Connor, do you have anything specific you want to add to that?
I can if you'd like. 7-11. I'll be quick, I promise.
40,000 feet.
So right now, the bylaws kind of give a frame of where things need to be posted for the warrants that's very outdated. For example, all of the firehouses in the town, and one of those is locked all the time, so no one can get in. Even my constables can't get in. And
the
other
one... I can tell them where the key
is. So thank you. That would be great. And the other... is been pretty much cut off from the public for the most part. The idea would be moving that to a public safety facility like the police station where there's 24-hour access. Other instances are just where public areas where residents give a lot of foot traffic, like the senior center and the public library. I like to post there anyway, but codifying it really allows it that it'll continue on beyond me. Along with just the change of wording from, I recommended a change in wording from the churches of the town to places of worship so that it kind of covers a broader range of diversity that our town has seen over the past few years as well.
Excellent. Everybody good? Adopt the nuisance bylaw.
I am not good with that.
That's one. Anybody else?
I don't know much about it.
Yeah, could I hear about that? I'm sorry.
Mr. Kamal, a little bit more detail at 40,000 feet, please.
Well,
over Lane, if you may.
Mrs. Lazarus.
The Zoning Advisory Committee reviewed request to look at nuisance regulations. They developed a potential zoning bylaw, and they also looked at a potential general bylaw. The zoning one has gone to the planning board, which declined to submit it into the warrant. This one is a general bylaw, which is basically identical to Upton's bylaw that they adopted a year or so ago.
But, I'm sorry, but I still don't know what it is.
Oh, it's in your packet. Yeah, so basically...
You can't store junk in your front yard.
Or you'd have to screen it and remove it.
Yeah, basically if you want to have, several cars...
Is this trying to fix something that we did a couple of years ago? Didn't we do something a couple of years ago with? I'm not opposed to it. I'm fine with continuing to look into this.
Well, yeah, I want to look into it because I think the intention was good, but I think it goes much too far. It's much too heavy-handed. You start to look into the internals, it is ripe for neighborhood disputes, for people using this thing to get after their neighbor because he's got a pile of bricks in his backyard, or how much paint does the house really need? There's lots of opportunities for this to really, I think, go too far. I think it's an overreach. If it were scaled back, it would be good, but this is Big Brother as far as I'm concerned. That's just me.
Okay, anybody else? So I think we have enough support at least to go to town meeting with, or try to get the article going to town meeting as a placeholder. Is that a fair statement? Okay. Well, with some concern, I understand, but at least in terms of tonight's action. Revise the kennel bylaw. Everybody okay? We'll have to figure out what those details are, but authorize lease negotiations on Fruit Street property for Bay Path Humane Society for access. Okay.
I'm okay with continuing a discussion on that, but Mr. Kamalo, I'd like to find out more information about Bay Path Humane Society, what their status is. I don't know if it's a profit or nonprofit, what our precise relationship is with them.
Senior tax relief, additional tax relief, I'm assuming, opportunities or mechanisms for tax relief.
Correct, yes.
I love this one. I love giving the seniors a break. They deserve to live here. So,
Municipal Modernization Act provisions.
Yeah, as we all know, Governor Baker identified opportunities for towns to act on specific issues. What we've done in-house is we had an individual come in, review all our bylaws, review the opportunities that are provided by the Municipal Modernization Law. We're now talking with Town Council to see if there are any specific articles that the town could move through town meeting. We'll come back to the board with any specific items. For example, the board has talked about the town's ability to regulate speed limits. We may take advantage of the law to bring forward to town meeting an instrument that is advantageous to the community.
Okay, the chair will entertain a motion to advance items 3 through 14 as presented this evening on the Board of Selectmen ATM article list for further discussion, but place them on the annual town meeting warrant as a placeholder at a minimum.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Kamala, go ahead.
Oh, no, that comes in late. Okay. Yes.
Didn't you have?
Yeah, we're going to come back to that. So on items 3 through 14, the chair is entertaining a motion to advance these to place them as a, placeholder, and to have further discussion on them in future meetings prior to town meeting. Is that a fair motion?
Yes, that's fair.
Did someone make a motion? And is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second for items 3 through 14 to advance to the placeholder position. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Mr. Catino.
The Vice Chairman will entertain a motion to approve 1 and 2 as placeholders in the town warrant for this spring.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
No one abstained?
It's a 4-0 vote.
He's not here. Yeah.
Oh, I'm recused from those.
Okay. Not even here.
Okay. Mr. Chair.
Mr. Sorry. 15.
I'd like to suggest an addition to the list. I'd like to propose that we put forward a motion for an underwrite to decrease the town's excess levy capacity after the new budget is approved to a level of $1.5 million. A couple of years ago, we approved an underwrite to $1.25 million. We have since grown up to over $3.2 million, and I think it needs to be pruned back again.
Okay. Mr. Kamal.
As a placeholder, is the language simply authorizing the board to submit an article for an underwrite, realizing that
I want the placeholder to be at the same authority level as all these others so that we can put something in there and have it on the warrant
exactly.
That can be approved and have the underwrite. So
yeah.
Whatever we need.
Okay, I think that's fine. The board can define the amount at a later date.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'll second it.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to advance the underwrite article to placeholder status with further detail to come. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Mr. Kamalo, item number 7.
Yes, Mr. Chair, if I may, just concluding on this item, for the sake of the new board members, these are items that we honestly felt the board should sponsor. We will also come back with other articles in the future that are proposed by departments that report either to the town manager and to the board and ask the board to sponsor those articles, simply because at town meeting, the town manager can't move in motion.
Okay.
Great. Thank you. We also, in the process, identified items that the board will need to present as ballot questions to the town clerk's office. We realize that the deadline for doing so will occur prior to the board's next scheduled meeting. And we are proposing 6 ballot questions. The first addresses the town's ability to remove snow and ice from private ways. This is an issue that the board has been discussing for a while. We did learn that this is a practice that the town already does this work. Town Council identified the need for the town to actually seek town meeting approval for this work to continue. So that's why we're coming back to the board and saying, should we be posing this as a ballot question. It's required by law to be posed as a ballot question, I should say.
The manner in which that's worded on the ballot is going to be very important, or it's going to cause a great deal of confusion.
As we've learned over the years, the legislation in terms of structuring ballot questions is very tight, and we did circulate this to Town Council.
This is his wording.
Yeah, this is Town Council's wording.
Do we have a lot of private ways that we remove snow on?
Yeah, we did the review. There's a list. There's a long list.
Yeah.
May I ask? So this, in other words, would apply to something like where it says therein open to public use. So it would apply to something like Rice Street or a street that has, for whatever reason, not been accepted as a public way. But it would not be understood to apply to private development roads, like the development road in Pinecrest Village.
That is correct.
So it's not going to open the door for these private developments to later now come and say, well, you should also be plowing Pinecrest Village.
Will not.
Or Legacy.
Yes, will not.
Okay, it's only those roads that have not been accepted as public ways but aren't in a private development.
Yes, and in fact, from our perspective, it's the private roads where the town is already doing the work.
Correct. Okay.
There's no intention to expand the list.
No, I just don't want it to be worded in such a way that then we could be forced to expand it.
Yeah.
Other than Rice Street, can you give me a couple of names just so I can...
Yeah, let me see if I can pull this up. We did prepare a report for the
board. 37,500 feet.
Wait. John, do you remember?
Previously, it was Penn Metal Lane.
We had a list of a couple dozen of them, though, anyway.
Exactly.
The Lake Area streets?
Yeah, Lake Area.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Lake Area.
Okay, number two.
We've gone back and forth with Town Council on this issue. We have received advice from our government practitioners, namely that other towns are actually passing a ballot question or putting forth a ballot question that completely prohibits the establishment of marijuana selling points in the community. Putting this forth for the board to consider.
So my understanding, is this something. This is something that the authority lies at the state level, and we really don't have the authority to say no. I mean, we can do it, you know, just you know, to say, hey, we say no. But in the end, the licensing comes from the state, and if somebody requests a license in Hopkinton from the state, and the state says yes, we can't stop them.
Correct that the licensing is at the state level, but the language right now in the law that was passed is ambiguous in terms of what towns could do. Mm-hmm. And what towns are doing proactively is to protect the community. They are either doing a moratorium or combining that moratorium with a ballot question prohibiting.
Mm-hmm. So it at least sends the state a message saying that, you know, whether you approve it or not, they're not welcome here.
Yeah.
Some are arguing that just like the casino licensing process, the local communities, the host communities, do have a say, and that's what this would basically parallel or mirror.
Yeah.
So can't hurt to try, at least for those that don't want to see it.
I agree. I just don't want everybody to get their hopes up that, you know, this is going to be the be all end all. Mm.
Do we have a moratorium? Wasn't there an understanding that cities and towns have a 1-year moratorium because everybody kind of needs to figure this out?
So we apply for it, and that we did.
We did?
The planning board voted for it, right?
Because, I mean, if this doesn't go through, we certainly should be looking to set up some kind of zoning to limit where it goes. I'm very worried about these three small shops that are all available right up here next to yogurt and in between the pizza parlor where all the kids go.
Are we going to have to change our sign?
Yeah. Highest town.
To that point, through the chair.
You pan over to that sign over there.
The planning board will be proposing an article requesting the approval of a moratorium for 18 months at this annual town meeting.
Number three.
God, it's getting late.
Number three, the following, in fact, the next four are budget related. There are items that we identified in the budget that we felt perhaps the board may want to move over to the, if the board is inclined to include them in the budget, it require that they be approved subject to a ballot vote. They include the HVA system on the Main Street Fire Station roof, the AstroTurf field, the 5-year capital sidewalk plan, and the traffic and pedestrian safety improvements on Hayden Road.
Okay.
I don't like number four to be anywhere.
Yeah, nope. There's no way I'm supporting that being on the ballot.
The AstroTurf field.
Nope. And I'd like to discuss trying to push number five out a year.
Okay, so on the AstroTurf fields, there isn't a consensus to do that, from what I just heard, so I think we need to take it off.
Take it off.
Do we need to have an official vote, or since it's on the agenda?
Well, we're going to vote all in one and back that one out.
That's right.
And on number five, I'm not opposed. Like, I think that the town needs some sidewalks, but we've lasted 300 years without Wild Road having a sidewalk, and I don't think there's a tremendous increase in traffic there. So I see that as frivolous as far as want versus need. But some of the Wood and West Main Street, I think some of those are rather important due to the higher traffic and developments and things like that with the Mews. But Wild Road, I think, is nothing that we need to do.
That was the one that caught my ear, too.
Yeah, I couldn't figure that one out. Oh, there's nothing on.
Okay, so is that all of them, Mr. Kamal?
Yes.
All right, so the chair will entertain a motion to approve ballot questions for, can you just give me the categories again, Mr. Kamal? Which
it's title one each? Through six. The first one is in regard to authorizing the town to appropriate money for the removal of snow and ice from private ways therein open to public
okay,
use.
Let's do them one at a time. All those in favor? So somebody want to make a standing affirmative motion for these six warrant articles?
I would make a standing affirmative motion.
I'll second it.
Okay, so we have a standing affirmative motion for the six that we're talking about, okay? Everybody good with that? You know how that works? So he's just going to hit each one, and we're going to say yay or nay. Mr. Kamal.
Number two.
No, I'm sorry. No. We got to take a vote on number one. What was number one again?
We don't have
number
to read one. Them all again, do we?
No, don't read them all again. Just give me the name of it.
Removal of snow and ice.
All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Mr. Kamal.